over 400,000 NCAA student athletes. And just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports.
Including Broadway shows and the historic Capitol Theater. That's why so many are saying we offer more. More accessibility, more centralized location, more cost savings for business, more fun with museums, shopping, nightlife, and a huge music scene. More restaurants offering everything from our own brand of fish and our own style of pizza to great local eateries and fine gourmet dining. More development and growth, a revitalized riverfront, unique shopping at our center market, and the Highlands. State-of-the-art government buildings, global operations centers, casinos, resorts, more technology, more excellent schools, more excellent healthcare, more sports, like our own pro hockey team, the Wheeling Nailers, and a short ride to the Pittsburgh Steelers, Penguins, and Pirates. And to top it off, Wheeling is more appealing. Recognized as one of the most livable small metros in the country, it all adds up to an energetic and welcoming city. Modern, progressive, and moving forward again. So now you know. Go ahead, enjoy the Wheeling Metro. Move yourself or a business here. Find a site and start or grow a company here. Explore our excellent funding sources and tax incentives. Learn about our business resources and live in the comfort, safety, and low-cost environment right here in the center of America. Wheeling, a city that's growing, transforming, innovating, inviting, and a city dedicated to making things happen for you. I'm John Corbett, and Wheeling is the place I call home.
Thank you.
There are over 400,000 NCAA student athletes. And just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports.
Jonathan Barrett, Richmond, Virginia, Political Economic Philosophy.
Nicurdy Barrows, Parkersburg, West Virginia, Athletic Training.
Logan Bowman, Fairmont, West Virginia, Criminal Justice.
Preston Bowser, Springfield, Ohio, Nursing.
Colin Clark, Yorksville, Ohio, Athletic Training.
Cody Eggers, Cleveland, North Carolina, Sports Management.
Terrence Fanning, Brewster Mills, West Virginia, Criminal Justice.
Stephen Frazier, Philo, Ohio, Biology Pre-Med.
Peyton Geary, Fremont, Ohio, Psychology.
Eric Green, Plum, Pennsylvania, Nursing.
Kyle Harris, Canalford, Ohio, Criminal Justice.
Jacob Haynes, Toronto, Ohio, English and Education.
Josh Henderson, Rogers, Ohio, Accounting.
Jalen Hill, Canton, Ohio, Athletic Training.
Brad Kakos, Columbus, History and Education.
Cody Kernan, Inwood, West Virginia, Criminal Justice.
Tyler Knoll, Circleville, Ohio, Business.
Maxwell Lacey, Columbus, Ohio, Business Management.
Jared Lazier, Caldwell, Ohio, Education.
Sawyer Lepla, Cambridge, Ohio, Engineering.
Scott Lopez, Morgantown, West Virginia, Chemistry and Pre-Med.
Dominic Nania, Greensburg, Pennsylvania, Education.
Damon Outward, Martins Ferry, Ohio, Nursing.
Kale Rayner, Caldwell, Ohio, Business Management.
Kyle Ryder, Fort Campbell, Kentucky, Athletic Training.
Corey Siegfried, Canton, Ohio, Criminal Justice.
Anthony T.J. Smith, Cleveland, Ohio, Athletic Training, Physical Therapy.
Seth Smith, Harrisville, West Virginia, Math and Secondary Education.
Miguel Staples, Middle Virginia, Nursing.
Nate Starkey, Ripley, West Virginia, Elementary and Special Education.
Skylar Terrell, Parkersburg, Biology.
Justin Trent, Colonial Heights, Virginia, Nursing.
Reese Walbrown, Indian Lake, Ohio, Undecided.
Dustin Warner, Denison, Ohio, Education.
Jerry Whaling, Colonial Heights, Virginia, Computer Science.
Nolan Whiteley, Cleveland, Ohio, Business.
Ryan Winslow, Gannett, Pennsylvania, Business.
Welcome, everybody, to Wrestling Cardinal Style. Don Watson, along with Rick Welker and Scott Jackson.
Welcome to the McDonough Center tonight for the wrestling dual meet for the first time ever here at Wheeling Jesuit University at the McDonough Center. We'll have the Cardinals of Wheeling Jesuit University against the Hilltoppers of West Liberty University. I'm expecting an extremely, extremely competitive match here this evening. This evening we will have many ranked, regionally ranked wrestlers going at it to
Can you hear me, Rick?
So,
after
You there, Rick?
I'm here. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Sorry about that. We
had a little technical difficulty. Sorry.
We got it all worked out. Once again, Wheeling Jesuit, West Liberty, barn burner here at the McDonough Center on the campus of Wheeling Jesuit University. We've got some presentations to make tonight. They're going to recognize Wheeling Wrestling as well as the Saints and Sinners for contributions and for things that they've done for Wheeling Jesuit Wrestling.
You know what, Rick? They always put on a class act show out here with Sean Doyle leading the program. They always recognize the young kids, you know, keep them involved in the program, give them a little bit of recognition so that – and he's a smart guy, too. This is a little self-edification here. Bringing these kids up, hey, this guy's he's a big leaguer in our town. You know, if I can get on to the college level, I'd like to wrestle at Wheeling Jesuit. So I appreciate everything that Sean's doing. I think he's doing an outstanding job, and I think when he recognizes the young kids like that in the junior wrestling, it's just an amazing thing for him to do.
Absolutely. And, you know, we're going to have the National Guard here to present the colors prior to. This is an event. Sean has made this an event. He was promoting it on radio, TV, Facebook, social media. He was out there getting people here. The crowd is great. I would say it's probably 60-40 Jesuit, and it's going to be an outstanding match. Tonight, we're going to referee is going to be Fred Feeney and Willing Park, former Willing Park head coach, and West Virginia chapter of the National Hall of Fame member, Buzz Evans.
Buzzy. National Anthem coming up there, Rick.
So we're going to cut off to the National Anthem, and then we'll be right back here at the McDonough Center of Wheeling Jesuit University. I want to thank the members of the Army National Guard or the Army Reserve to coming and presenting the colors.
Absolutely.
And to all of you out there who have served. Scott, thank you for your service.
You too, Rick.
And, it was a good time for us. We're going to go through the starting lineups for tonight.
125 pounds,
Dustin Warner versus Zach Brown of West Liberty.
Okay, 133 pounds. We have number one, Nolan Whiteley from Wheeling Jesuit versus Joe Wagstaff coming out of West Liberty.
And 141 pounds, sixth-ranked Skylar Terrell versus Anthony Craig of West Liberty.
149 pounds, Preston Beauchire versus number three, Joel Paolo from West Liberty.
157 pounds, my premier match of the night, Dom Nania of Wheeling Jesuit against Cameron's David Schleiper from West Liberty.
And 165 pounds, we have Reyes Wall Brown of Wheeling Jesuit versus number three, Eric Antonsberger or DeMondre Turner. Which one's wrestling tonight, Rick?
It is probably going to be Eric Antonsberger.
All right, there you go.
And 174 pounds from West Liberty, Parkersburg native Jordan Nolan against the number two ranked Sawyer Lepla.
And then going on to 184 pounds, we have the number three ranked Ryan Winslow out of Wheeling Jesuit. He's going to be wrestling against Danny Doyle, a family member there, the head coach of the Wheeling Jesuit Cardinals. Danny Doyle's wrestling for West Liberty tonight. That's going to be a little bittersweet match there.
And 197 pounds upstart from Wheeling Jesuit will be Maxwell Lacey versus Nathan Dawson.
And to finish it out, 285, we have Corey Siegfried from Wheeling Jesuit versus number five, Aaron Silverio from West Liberty. And as Rick said, that's going to be one of the pivotal matches in this meeting tonight. And we're ready to get on to some outstanding wrestling tonight here at the McDonald Center at Wheeling Jesuit University.
And it's always, always, always electric during wrestling matches here at Wheeling Jesuit.
You know what, Rick? I'm amazed at the crowd they have out here for a wrestling match. You usually don't see this until mid-season, late season, when it really counts. But this is a big event, like you said earlier. Doyle turned this into an event, and I think it's going to be it's just going to continue to grow and get better and better each and every year as it has from last year.
And let's talk a little bit about the coaches, Scott. You got Brian Davis, the national champion, the head coach of West Liberty University. Sean Doyle, a Wheeling native, went to Butler Local High School in Ohio, is a graduate of Cornell, and is in his second year of college head coaching experience. He's building a program, and he's trying. Let's be real honest here. West Liberty has the history of success. Jesuits in its second season, who had a winning record in their first season, with all true freshmen in the lineup.
Right.
So I think that this is going to be an extremely, extremely competitive match. Not only is Sean coaching against one of his good friends, Brian Davis, but he's also going to coach against his cousin, Danny Doyle, at 184 pounds.
Right, and you know what else is going to happen throughout the years? He's going to also coach against some of the kids that he trained and he taught throughout the little leagues and stuff that have come through the Wheeling Wrestling Program
Wheeling Park,
that end up going to Wheeling Jesuit, West Liberty.
Absolutely. It's going to be a great night of wrestling here at the McDonough Center, and it should be something very, very, very exciting to see it here as we get the heavyweights announced. We've got Corey Siegfried once again, Aaron Severio out of Shadyside, Ohio. I believe he was an OVAC champ in his high school days. And like I said earlier, Scott, on our show, these two are athletic heavyweights that are going to get in there and go at it right out of the gate.
Yeah, you know what, Rick, that's pretty exciting to me, because coming through wrestling all the years that I've wrestled, most of the heavyweights weren't real athletic. You know, you would see one here and there and everywhere, but you get onto the college level, and you know, you got to kick it up a notch. You see these guys in there shooting single legs, double legs. They're not just pummeling and trying to snap somebody down and do some tricky stuff like that. They're actually out there getting at it, trying to do some single legs, some double legs, you know, fireman carries and stuff like that. It's pretty amazing to watch a 200-pound man go out there and wrestle like that.
Well, and what the viewers can expect tonight to see is a lot of basic, basic, non-gimmicky wrestling. You know, they're going to shoot double legs, they're going to sprawl, they're going to crossface, they're going to block, they're going to spin, ankle waists, and things of that nature. And Scott, college wrestling, as we know, is different. And one of the major differences is riding time. You can gain an extra point if you accumulate a minute of riding time.
Right. And you know what? We talked about this last year a couple of times on this show. I think that should be taken down to, as we spoke many times last year, down to the high school level, because the progression from high school into college, if you don't have that, if you're not learning that in high school, you have to learn that once you come to college. And I think that sets you back as a freshman when you come in and you don't know about that riding time. I mean, you can know about it, but if it doesn't affect you in your match where you're consciously thinking about it while you're out there wrestling for 6 or 7 minutes, that could have a negative effect on you maybe in your first year wrestling.
And, you know, if you ride a kid for 2 minutes in high school, you get zero points. You get nothing for it.
Right.
Now, is it a win? Yeah, for the most part, it's a win. You know, here we go. We're getting ready to get going at 125.
How about Buzzy Evans out there? He was both of our coaches
head coach
in high school, huh?
Park, Buzz Evans. Also, Fred Feeney, a college wrestling, very experienced college wrestling official.
Right.
You know, he also had a part in the movie Foxcatcher.
No doubt.
Yeah, he was the official during some of the matches. I believe he also took care of some of the stage and some of the actual
matches. So we got an all-star cast out here tonight, huh?
Absolutely.
Right. Can't go wrong with Buzzy Evans. Look at him. Still looking slim, trim, and racy out there. Huh?
Ready to go.
He's ready to rock.
Here we go at 125 pounds. Claymont's Dustin Warner, Ohio State champion, against Zach Brown of Oak Glen, West Virginia. He wrestled for Larry Shaw, one of the West Virginia legends, as well as nationally with 13th straight West Virginia State AA.
Oak Glen
team champion.
You know what, Rick? I hated wrestling Oak Glen when we were in high school, man.
They were good. I mean,
they were always good. And who did we have down there? Johnny Crane?
John Crane.
Oh, how about that trip?
He was a 3-time state champ, so officials are at the table trying to work something out. And
Who's green?
And as I said earlier, they're starting at 125. For me, I wouldn't have wanted to start here, but I'm not sure in college. I think they have to start at 125.
Do they go straight through all the way?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, it's going to work out exactly how you said you wanted to be if you wanted to be Mr. Davis.
Absolutely. And here we go. Brown against Warner. And we're underway. First period of 3 minutes, 125 pounds. Warner going right in, getting aggressive with Brown. Number five, Zach Brown against unranked Dustin Warner from Wheeling Jesuit. Yeah. Center of the mat looks as
Zach
if Brown's
down
going to
his
knees. I'm not sure. You know, I don't understand the the good snap down there initially by Warner.
Uh-huh. This is one of those weight classes where you expect a lot of action, but you know, they're just out there kind of feeling each other out right now. You know, tying up, seeing who's got the strength, who's got the speed, and they're just kind of feeling each other out at this point, I think, right now.
And we've got, when you look into the West Liberty wrestler, Brown is a big 125 pounder.
They're pretty solid-looking athletes out there.
Warner's just, you know, looks like Warner's a true 25-pounder. It looks like he's probably not coming down too much. But Brown looks to be a little bit stockier, a little bit stronger. He's number fifth-ranked wrestler in the region. Just a lot of feeling each other out, a little bit of hand-fighting. Minute 58 remaining in the period, as you can see in the top right corner. We've got the running clock weight class. The top numbers will be for riding time. Nobody seems to be too active, too aggressive. Nobody wants to make a mistake, which... kind of a soft shot there by Warner.
You know what, Rick? I think at the early parts of the match, it's okay to go out and fill a guy out, but I think you got to go after him. You know what I mean? All this touching around and feeling stuff, I think you got to get in there and get aggressive with him.
And I don't think Fred's going to let him do this too much longer. We're halfway through the period, no shots.
There's no shots, nothing going on, just a lot of feeling, a lot of down on the knees from Zach Brown from West Liberty. He's kind of laying on the, or, you know, on his hands and knees in the middle of the rat. I just don't like that.
Well, here comes Warner trying to push the pace. 1:13 remaining in the first period. Another half.
Nice little snap down. Nothing doing, though. You know, they're still in the center of the mat. We still got Brown down on his knee. And Warner working around him in the center of the mat on the Cardinal, trying to get an angle on him, touching the head. You know, maybe trying to get him up off his knee so he might be able to try to do something here.
And
there
key note, Warner is not
there
getting
we go. Now
too impatient. There's Fred Feeney calling a stalemate.
Right.
And just trying to get some action going here. 50 seconds remaining, first period, 125-pound
there's
match. Shot by
there
Warner.
We go. There you
he's
go.
In
pulled
deep.
In.
Looks like Brown's trying to get a little bit of that far ankle. He's
pulling the ankle in.
He's going to try to get him
over
to his hip here, Scott. He's going to get him to his hip. Feeney's going to call stalemate here in about 5 seconds.
Warner needs to get the head out of there. Get it up to the belly. One or the other. Pull that leg in. They're still stalemate. Call it back to the
31 seconds remaining. Warner in on a shot. Nothing doing there. Good block by Zach Brown.
I'd like to see a little more action at this weight class, Rick. You
absolutely.
Know?
One shot during 2 minutes and 30 seconds. It just looks as if the match is so important in the overall dual meet that neither one of them wants to make a big mistake. I didn't think it was a bad shot by Dustin. He just was unable to finish, which was because of good defense by Zach Brown.
Outstanding defense, and I agree 100%. But you know what? You can't wrestle a match to not make a mistake. You have to go out there and wrestle your
match.
You have to be aggressive, and you have to be the offensive man out there trying to make things happen on your end, not defending against the other guy, not trying to make a mistake.
And Feeney's going to have to bring Brown up off his knee. Is it stalling? I don't know. But it was a choice.
He's definitely not making any effort to take a takedown.
No,
he's down
not.
On his knees looking up
he's
at the guy.
He's just defending himself. Jesuit was had choice. They chose to defer. And Zach Brown chooses down going into the second period. 0-0 score. As I stated before to the listeners out there, you'll start to see the clock on the top go up. That's riding time. Warner is a pretty good rider. Brown has been broke down flat here. And Warner's staying heavy on the head here.
Staying heavy on the head, tight waist, shooting a half. Warner trying to work that half across, break him down. He's got him down flat. You know, he's trying to get that half up in there and maybe turn him over a little bit. Tight waist, reaching across, grabbing the opposite shoulder. Try to snap him back a little bit.
You know, Warner getting this to a minute is actually, I believe, it's going to be a win at 30 seconds in riding time because that may be the difference of the match. He's at 34 seconds, and he seems to be in good control. Brown's flat and has been unable to come up to his base.
Right. And you know what? If Zach Brown doesn't come out of there and get a point, which you've got to score from the bottom.
You have to.
You have to get that 1 point. If you don't get that 1 point and you give up a minute ride time in the second period, you go into the third period, you're way down. You're down 2 points.
Unless you can ride for the whole – because you're
even if you ride for the whole period, you're still down 1 point.
Absolutely. And right now we're in bonus time for – stalemate
again.
Going to stalemate. 102 on the riding time, which will continue to climb as Dustin Warner is in the top position.
I thought Dustin looked good. I thought he looked good riding there. He was trying some different angles on him, trying some different things with the arms and with the shoulders, with the half Nelson and the tight waist. I just think the guy from West Liberty, Zach Brown, I just think he's stalling a little bit too much. I don't think he's trying to be aggressive. I think he's just trying to not make a mistake, like you said earlier.
Warner's in a precarious situation right here. He's got a leg underneath. Brown's trying to – oh, he gets his hip back up. That's great. That's great wrestling right there, Scott.
It is.
He gets your hip down. You got to keep them hips up. That's what makes a great rider.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the West Liberty bench once feet, referee Fred Feeney, he's going to hit him for stalling.
Stalling, there it is. Thanks, ref. There you go. The crowd don't like it, but I'm here to tell you, Zach Brown ain't doing a whole lot on the mat right now, except for trying to keep out of trouble.
I feel that Mr. Feeney was baited into that call by assistant coach Brandon Hinkle.
Yeah.
Coach Davis seems to be relaxed and calm in his corner.
Dustin Warner, I've seen some pretty good wrestling so far from him. He's tried a lot of different angles. He's constantly switching sides on the body, trying to break him down and roll him over to get some back points. As far as it goes, his aggressiveness, I give him the aggressiveness right now in the match. And I think the ref was right to hit Zach Brown with a stalling.
No, he hit Warner. He hit Warner for stalling.
Okay.
And now Green has just been hit.
Okay, good.
They've both got a warning there. We've got 2 seconds remaining. That is a win. Let me tell you this. That is a win for Dustin Warner. He's got 2 minutes of riding time. He's going to go under. Essentially, right now, he's winning 1-0.
Right. And if he's going on bottom, too, Ricky. All he has to do is escape. He's up 2 points.
Absolutely.
So that's an outstanding job on his part. And I'm sure Sean's following this close over there on the corner of the mat.
I think this is a pivotal match in the duel meet right
here. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Warner comes out with a win over number 5, Zach Brown. That's a match that you don't expect
to win. He's up. Hit the switch. Can you get out of it?
Nope.
No.
So Brown looks to be good. He's had heavy on the head.
Once again, he's up. Warner's him off. Get out.
Once again, he's up. He's got to stay on his feet here. He's got to return him to the mat. He's got to return him to the mat.
Right. Oh, he's turning into it. There's a reversal. There we go. Dustin Warner gets a reversal.
He's up
2-0 on Zach Brown.
So it is essentially 3-0.
It's 3-0.
And he's looking to take that arm over the head to turn him to his back.
128. That's outstanding wrestling, Rick. Outstanding wrestling right there.
And they've got the clock going in the wrong direction. That should be going up. The
riding
top.
It is going up now.
He should be as you were. You know what the problem was? They didn't switch it over. It should be. We should be at about 2 minutes and 10 seconds of riding time.
Right. Okay.
It'll be locked up at 9 seconds. It's irrelevant at that point. We can get back points here.
Yep.
Don't get too out of control, Dustin.
Get that arm. They're clear out of bounds. They're going to stop it? All right.
One minute, one second.
Wrestling from my man Dustin Warner from Wheeling Jesuit.
Riding time is locked up. It's essentially locked up.
3-0.
3-0. Good
zip.
Call, Scott.
He's got to get an escape
and a takedown
to just tie it up.
Absolutely.
He is way behind the eight ball.
And he's been unable to move down
Nothing.
There.
He's been broken down flat every single time the whistle blows. There's a false start. Caution.
That's okay. We got one more to burn.
That's why they give you two of them, right?
Exactly.
That's right.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match here has been, it started slow, but it got exactly what we would expect from a 125-pound match. Warner, once again, going straight to that spiral ride.
Rick, he is all over him. I'll tell you what, Dustin Warner is riding him like he's a little pony at the fair, man. He is all over him.
And Zach Brown, you know, he just seems to be having trouble to get up. It doesn't even look like he's attempting to get to his feet.
Yep.
And here goes Warner. Oh,
he's turning
back.
Over.
Once he got a one count.
Is he get a one?
He got a one count. No points there. He's still good there.
You got 35 seconds to go in the third. Still no point.
So now reversal.
Now we got a
reversal. Brown. It is now 3-2. 24 seconds remaining.
3-2. 24. He's going to get an escape. He's going to get an escape if he lets him up. Get your head out of there. Dustin Warner gets out. He gets an escape. We're equal. 3-2. Dustin Warner from Willie
12 Jesuit. Seconds remaining. Brown's in tight on a takedown. He doesn't got two yet. Seven seconds.
Five, four, three, two, one.
That is a huge win
over Zach Brown.
For Wheeling Jesuit University.
Absolutely. That is an absolute phenomenal start for the Wheeling Jesuit Cardinals to come out and win that first match against your number 5 seed, Zach Brown. I just, you know what, Rick? I don't think he wanted it. Like I said, I think this match was done. He wanted it. He come out to try not to make
very,
any mistakes.
Very, very, very flat. Here we go. 133 pounds, number 1 ranked. Nolan Whiteley versus Joe Wagstaff.
Here we go.
And on the team score, it is 3-0, Wheeling Jesuit.
Here we go. Shaking hands. 133 is underway. There we go. Got a little more action this one. They look a little more aggressive than the 125-pounders, Rick. Somebody in there wants to wrestle.
Well, we're head-to-head, center of the mat, 1 foot on the Cardinal for Whitley. Wagstaff working ahead, keeping pressure on the head, keeping his head buried, which is a good place to be. Whiteley's got to get his head out of there.
Whiteley's got a left arm. It looks like he's trying to do an arm drag. Got him down to the mat. They're all both on their knees. Both trying for head control. A little snap back. Shuck around. If he gets over, he gets two. He's almost in. There's two. Nolan Whiteley, two on the takedown. Nice riding. Whiteley's got Wagstaff broken down flat on the right side of the mat, trying to get some arm control. Broke him flat. Now he's trying to shoot the half with a tight waist. Maybe turn him over and get some back points here, Rick.
I'll tell you what, Jesuit is just riding phenomenally. You know, 2 minutes in, 1 minute into the match, we've got a takedown and 23 seconds of riding time already racked up. Which is,
absolutely.
He's just kind of riding him like a dog.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Now let me ask you something, Rick. You think Coach Doyle pushes that ride time?
You're absolutely right.
Guaranteed. That's a free point, man.
Every single time.
That's a free point.
And here
every
he is.
Time.
Got a boot in right now, staying heavy, trying to pressure him down.
Got legs in. Oh, he's got him flat.
He's
got both legs
tight,
in.
Big legs.
Mashing the head
in the air
into the,
like
mashing
that.
The face into the mat, trying to get an arm up there on the head. He's got his left elbow up on the top of his head, trying to get his head down, turn his arms underneath.
And I'll tell you what, Joey Wagstaff, I've got an opportunity to spend a little bit of time with him when I was working at West Liberty. Great kid, came up from Florida and walked on to the Jesuit wrestling team. Good kid. Just having a little bit of trouble. Oh, we're going to go with the stalemate here.
Okay.
Here we're going to go back to the center. 2-0. Nolan
Whiteley's up 2-0. He's riding on top of Joe Wagstaff. We got a minute 22 left in the second period, but a 107 ride time for Mr. Nolan Whiteley out of William Jesuit. Here we go. Wagstaff gets set on the lines.
Officer, okay, start letting him up. You got a point locked up. Let's get another take down here.
Yeah, 2-1.
You know, Scott, as a coach, if you're going to let a kid up, you better take him down.
Yeah, absolutely, Rick. If you let a kid up and you get taken down, you know what? If I'm a coach, I'm pretty jacked. I'm pretty jacked at you. But you know what? Hey, Nolan's number one for a reason, right? And he did get the first takedown, so maybe he feels better up there. You know, give up one, take two, you're getting 1 point ahead every time.
And they're going to go out of bounds on the Jesuit side of the mat, bringing him back to the center, referee Fred Feeney. And here we go, underway again, 58 seconds remaining in the first period. Whiteley is a freshman out of Chagrin Falls, Ohio.
Yeah.
And here we go. What do we got here? Oh, we got a slap to the eye.
Nah, that never hurt nobody, huh?
Well, you know,
if you're
going
to take him out, just point him in the eye.
It's wrestling.
That's right.
Once again, surprisingly, Coach Davis has been in
pretty
his
quiet.
Seat. Yeah, not saying too much. He's an intense coach, and he's chosen to kind of relax tonight. 3-0 team lead for Wheeling Jesuit. Now Whiteley's down on his knee. Wagstaff counters.
Another little shuck. He almost got behind him again.
Here we go, head-to-head.
Head-to-head.
Not much action going on.
Nope,
25 seconds remaining in the first period. Clock can be followed on the right-hand corner of the screen.
There's a nice shot for a single leg, a little fireman.
Oh, he's jumping him over.
That was absolutely amazing. Nice. Nolan Whiteley gets a fireman takedown, and he gets 2 more points, 4-1. Nolan Whiteley, the number one ranked individual at 133 over Joe Wagstaff from West Liberty. And we have 1:18 left in the first period, and the ride time is now up to a minute and 21 seconds.
1:21 riding time, as you said,
yeah.
Scott. So
we're in the second period now. 2 minutes to go in the second period. Just getting started.
Wagstaff choice defers, and Whiteley chooses to go underneath.
Right.
This is a change of position. We haven't seen this yet with Wagstaff on top.
Right.
Maybe he can turn him and pick up those 3 points
that
he's down.
But he's going to have to, because if he lets him up, then he's down 5-1. Now he's really behind the eight ball.
And it's a big eight ball right now.
Yeah, yes it is.
And here we go. Looks like hand control,
and he's
up and out.
5-1.
Nolan Whiteley.
They're neutral. Nolan Whiteley and Joe Wagstaff on their feet in the center of the mat. You know what? I give it to Nolan Whiteley. He's got 2 takedowns so far. He had a nice fireman's carry last time. At this point, I think he's the strongest wrestler on the mat when they're standing up neutral.
Well, now he's got to start thinking about bonus points. Up essentially 6-1 with the riding time. He's got to get up to 9-1. We'll get him an 8-point major decision. Pick up 4 big points for Wheeling Jesuit heading into the 141-pound match, which I believe should be a ball.
There's
he's in deep
again. It's there again. Turn it over. Turn it over. He's got it. Turn it over.
He's got to trap that
far leg. He's got to get his head out. Get behind him. Pop your head out.
Is.
There it is. Takedown. He caught him twice in the fireman.
7-1.
7-1. What'd you say? We're going to get the 9-1.
We need to
get
9-1. Get that 4 points. 8-point. 8-point margin there will get us that fourth. That bonus point.
Yeah,
for the
he's
major
he's got a lot of time. Well, if you look at the ride time, if he racks up another couple seconds here, he's going to almost guarantee that.
Another escape. Wagstaff looked to be ready for that fireman's as he blocked that arm coming in from Whiteley. Whiteley's wrestling
nice shuck and then to a slide by to a single leg. That's nice. If he can suck that in and get his head on the inside, he'll be all right. I think they're going to call him for a stalemate. They're kind of stuck real tight. There you go. Stalemate called.
We're sitting 8-2 right now, 36 remaining, second period.
7-2. 7-2.
7-2. I apologize. 7-2.
I'll tell you what, Wagstaff, he looks a little more winded than Whiteley does.
You know, Whiteley being a freshman, he came in here to prove a point, obviously. Mm-hmm. He's probably been training all summer, didn't take much time off, getting ready for his first collegiate season. And as of, you know, so far, he is absolutely making the most of it.
Well, there's another shuck by.
Yeah.
Great
little slide by.
Little slide by.
9-2.
2 more points, 9-2.
Essentially, right now, we've got a 10-2 score.
I think he's going to turn him over. If he can get that arm control, if he can pop that left arm out, he's got on him, he's got the legs in. What do we call it, stalemate?
No, end of the period. End of the second period, 9-2. Wagstaff is going to go under. It is essentially 10-2 with the riding time.
Right, he can't make up a minute 42 with 2 minutes left.
No.
Not when you're on the bottom. 10-2, that gives him 4 points, right?
Well, I'll tell you what I do. If I'm Doyle, I ride. Well, he's going to let him up right out of the gate. It is 9-3 on the scoreboard with the riding time. It is 10-3. So we need a takedown here from
Whiteley.
Whiteley.
Yeah, he gets one more takedown. He gets the 4 points for the team. I tell you, it's been a pretty good match, man. But I tell you what, Whiteley's been pretty slick.
He's in there
nice deep on a single leg. That was nice. He went right off like a touch and go. Touched the head, dropped right into the leg. Boom, he's there. Pops the head out. He's got two. Oh, there it is. Takedown.
Went to the ankle. 11-3.
11-3. Whiteley, Willie Jesuit, putting it on Joe Wagstaff from West Liberty. Minute 25 to go in the third period. And Whiteley's already racked up over 2 minutes of ride time, so he's got that extra bonus point for the ride time.
It'll
now
be locked 12-3. In 15 seconds.
Right.
He's working that arm, putting a half in here.
Yeah. You know
Feeney's coming down for either a stall. If he hits a stall, I'd be pretty surprised. Maybe a stalemate here, but you can't hit Whiteley for stalling.
If he's moving left and right, trying to put the head in.
Oh,
you know,
we're neutral.
All right, he let him out.
11-4.
11-4. He's got with the ride time, makes it 12-4.
Wagstaff needs a takedown to eliminate that
4 point.
Absolutely.
4 point team points. You know what? Whiteley's taking him down, what, three times, four times now
in
this match?
Every time he's won.
I don't think Wagstaff's
every
got
time
what
he's takes. Felt like it.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And you know what? It was. He went at him twice with the. There he did again. Same thing.
Just a little slide by.
Popped on the back of him. That's it. He's putting on a clinic here on takedowns, ain't he?
28 seconds remaining in the first period. I believe it'll probably end with around – I don't think that we're going to go for a technical fall. I think it's going to end 13-4 with the riding time.
Right.
Feeney's going to let the time run down. Nobody seems to complain too much about
– Rick, another outstanding win for the Cardinals, man. Well, I tell you what, they it looks to me like they want it.
I'll tell you
they
right
want
now.
It. They're on their home turf. They want this.
If I'm West Liberty, I take that as a win because it wasn't a six-pointer. I kind of got 2 points back.
Right.
Yep. Winner, Owen Whiteley. Final score coming up on time, 14-4. That's a major decision.
And we got a 14-4 major decision for Nolan Whiteley. That'll make this team score Wheeling Jesuit 7, West Liberty 0. Joining us here is Matt Antonucci. He's going to take us through the 141-pound weight class with Scott Jackson here at the Alma Grace McDonough Center here on the campus of West Wheeling Jesuit University.
Let's welcome the Whippy Warrior. How you doing, Matt? How you doing, buddy? You ready?
Absolutely. Good to be here. Thank you to Cardinal Cast. Thanks to Rick Walker for having me. I'm Matt Antonucci alongside Scotty J.
That's
the
right.
Man. And we're here at 141 pounds, Wheeling Jesuit and West Liberty University. Who we have for Jesuit going to 141?
We have Skylar Terrell, ranked number 6, and we have who's wrestling tonight? Cole Nace or Anthony Craig?
Is this Craig or Nace?
I don't know
Anthony
which
Craig
wrestling.
From West Liberty University at 141 pounds.
All right.
We stand here at the neutral position.
Both in the center of the mat. Hand on the mat.
Both looking to really get and what I've seen from the last couple of matches since I've been here, Scott, is that really looking to work a single early.
Yeah.
Try to get that first takedown, and that's huge.
Yeah.
When you're definitely the team wrestling on the road.
Yes.
From the dual meet perspective.
Absolutely.
Get that first takedown.
But you know what, too, Matt? You get a little nerves when you're out there that first minute or so into the match, and like that 125-pound mat that started this whole thing off. It just looked like nobody wanted to make a mistake. It wasn't like nobody was the aggressor. But right here, we got some aggressiveness going on now. We got the Wheeling Jesuit guy. He's in deep, and West Lib's defending it well. But all he's got to do is get behind him, and he'll have two. Nope. Right, they're back neutral.
All right, we're back neutral. And again, this is sixth-ranked Skylar Terrell from Wheeling Jesuit University and Anthony Craig from West Liberty kind of dancing back and forth here in the neutral position. It looked at Terrell had the first inklings of maybe getting his first two on a single leg.
He
shoots
in
another single leg on the left
leg up.
He's got the leg up looking to kick in.
There's two. Skylar Terrell from Jesuit. He gets the takedown with 1 minute 29 seconds left to go in the first period. They're wrestling on the edge of the ring. They're going to call him out of bounds.
Hey, guys, I also want to point out there, all you got to do is trap that far ankle. Once that far ankle's trapped in college, that's a takedown.
Okay.
You don't have to build up to get control. That's a takedown right there.
Awesome.
All right, we come to the middle here. This will be Terrell on top here in the referee's position.
Oh, you got a caution.
And you have those a lot more on the college level, Rick, than you do at the high school level.
Well, what I like, too, though, is that the referees take accountability. He called that on himself because, you know, a lot of the times the kids have the headgear on, and when you're in a gym like this with a lot of people, you're going off of, you're looking at the official, and you're looking for him to inhale and exhale. So when he exhales and you don't, and he doesn't get that whistle, which happens from time to time, the referee says, hey, that's on me.
Right. Okay. All right, here we have Terrell looking at – now, here the difference here, Scotty. You know, we have the difference here from the rest of the high school standpoint to the college standpoint.
Uh-oh, that was a nice little move.
We have riding time.
Riding time is a huge thing. And you know
here.
What, Matt? And I talked to Rick about this earlier, man. I'll bet Sean Doyle teaches that. That's a gimme point.
Mm-hmm.
That's a gimme point because they're going to give you 2 minutes because you're going to get the choice in one of the periods. If you can get that 2 minutes of ride time, if nothing else, you negate the other guy's ride time. So that's like a free bonus point
Absolutely.
To me. And you have to take advantage of that because when you're in college, you know, 1 point makes a huge difference.
Absolutely. And breaks it down to where we stand right now, 40 seconds remaining in the first period where Skylar Terrell, sixth ranked out of Wheeling Jesuit, leads 2-1 over Anthony Craig from West Liberty University. We are live here at the McDonough Center on the campus of Wheeling Jesuit University where Wheeling Jesuit holds a team lead. As 7-0 going into this match at 141 pounds.
Oh, there's a little snap down. Get behind.
Stay nice and basic. Nice and basic.
That's right.
There.
You got to get that arm from around the waist, and you can get two more points.
Bread and butter from Skylar there.
They're out of bounds. We're going to start neutral, get to the center of the mat. We have 10 seconds to go in the first period, and we have Skylar Terrell from Wheeling Jesuit leading Anthony Craig from West Liberty 2-1.
And Craig was a solid performer, too, out of Steubenville High School. It's a storied wrestling high school, too.
A storied everything.
Absolutely. And, you know, Parkersburg native Skylar Terrell, solid performer down there in the great school, the Big Red of Parkersburg High
now
School.
Now, here's the deep cut from Rick Welker. These two ever crossed paths before? Anthony Craig and Skylar Terrell.
No, not that I know of, unless they've done it in opens, because Skylar went to Parkersburg, which is not a part of the OVAC.
That's right.
Ironically, Parkersburg South is further away, but is in the OVAC.
Yeah, there's no method to that madness.
And now
and there's
two
an
two.
Escape point.
Now that's the tying point there for Anthony Craig from West Liberty with 1:45 remaining in period number two. It is an all-tied match here.
We are in the center of the mat where both guys are neutral, touch each other on the head, trying to get some hand control. This is anybody's match. It's been pretty even so far. It's each person.
Interest.
Oh, he's got a leg.
Oh, he's in
he's
deep.
He's in deep. He's got the
he's
leg. Grab the other ankle. We got two. We awarded two. Skylar right. Terrell with another takedown. And our score is now 4-2 with 1 minute 23 seconds to go in the second period. And we're going to start back in the center of the mat with Skylar Terrell on top of Anthony Craig.
And you know what, Rick, you might agree with me here. This is absolute total control. I mean, Anthony Craig is not – there is not even a remote – of a sprawl when Terrell's coming in to shoot.
Because
he gets deep on the first run,
too. Cutting such a great angle. And I was getting ready to mention that Coach Davis was out of his seat there approaching the mat and completely felt that Skylar was stalling and not climbing up the body. Kind of agree with him. I think he's got to work up a little bit. But nothing was called there. He called him out of bounds. And that's another escape from Anthony Craig. And a shot there. Be careful. A bad shot, Terrell will throw you.
Uh-huh.
Don't give him a big move.
I'm not impressed with Skylar Terrell's riding. He has been pretty sloppy both times that he gave him the escape point. He was just up too high, tried to ride the knee into the right side of the ribs, and he just kind of bounced him off of him, gave away 2 points like that.
Scotty, it comes back to what we were talking about earlier on the show, on the Rick Welker Wrestling Show, a show you can hear only on AM 1600 Wednesday nights from 6 to 7. And you just get a kid who's unranked, and not there in Anthony Craig, not to the level where Skylar Terrell is, especially with that number six ranking. As long as Anthony Craig can hang in this match, I don't take him out of it all the way to period number three.
Absolutely, unless you're up six, because Craig has the ability to throw a big move. And don't let the rankings fool you. He's not ranked. We've discussed this in depth. That doesn't mean he's not a quality performer. You know, this is a tough weight class.
Skylar
Terrell is a stud, and he's ranked six in that weight class.
Right. I think Skyler's riding too high. Now, I'm no coach or anything here, but he's ridden high two or three times like this, and Anthony Craig's been able to just bounce him off and get that easy point.
See, that's my favorite bottom escape move right there, the old sit-out turning.
Absolutely.
And you know what? It keeps everything right in front of you. Everything right in front of you and fresh. And I think that as far as the riding is concerned, to touch on what Scotty said, I mean, you're not going to get anything with a hip to wrist on a kid like Anthony Craig who can explode. Because you know what's going to happen if you get on that high wrist there, Rick, went from the bottom, you really open yourself up to maybe get turned around and even reversed.
There's too much open space. We've got Coach Doyle, a lot of room to move.
Coach Doyle with the table, he's asking something. I'm not sure what he's asking.
He's pretty animated. He's like locking hands. I don't see what he's talking about here. It's
Sean's
getting
ready.
One warning on
Sean's
green.
Been warning. Sean's been warned.
All right, Sean.
Rick, delve into the details of the locking the hands rule at the college level.
Well, it's essentially pretty much the same as in high school and the National Federation. I didn't see anything, and Sean's got a different angle than we do up here a little bit above the mat, but I didn't see anything that was unusual because Craig was never on top. I don't know if he thought something with Terrell or with the front headlock maybe that Craig may have had. He felt it was illegal.
And now Craig will take advantage with his first time on top in the match with
there's
140 remaining in period number three.
Yep.
Terrell escapes, and that extends his lead 7-4 here in period number three. And now, Rick, what is the main thing that has to happen if you're in the mind or if you're the coach of Skylar Terrell to hold on to this lead with a minute 20 remaining?
Well, I think you keep doing what's been successful, which has been aggressive on top.
From
the neutral position here, I don't think right now at 7-4 is a time for you to relax. Craig is placed in the state of Ohio. He's an OVAC champion. He can wrestle. And I think when you relax, bad things happen. Just stay with the game plan for the entire 7 minutes.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it. You take him down two or three different times, go back out there and be neutral, take him down.
Now, my wife would disagree with that. If it isn't broke, don't fix it. Because
let's jump to the other side.
Craig's
jump to the
deep
other
on
side of the
leg.
Spectrum here. Now with Anthony Craig deep on a single with a minute remaining, what do you do if you're Coach Davis, and what are you shouting to Anthony Craig here?
You've got to continue to attack. At some point, Scarrell's just got to give this up. See, there's a takedown.
We are 7-6, 41 seconds to go. And Skylar Terrell from William Jesuit is leading 8-6.
Now Coach Brian Davis is out of his seat. As well as the
I think he's complaining that the riding time didn't switch over. And we're going out of bounds. 26 seconds left.
Back to the center of the mat.
8-6.
Coach Davis is mid-mat, ladies and gentlemen. And he's on top of these officials, which I think from what Rick is saying is a riding time issue. Now here comes Coach Doyle to join the conversation. and Coach Davis
we're
is
gonna
putting
have
the
Doyle
hand up
and
here.
Davis out there wrestling here in a minute.
Oh, no.
I think it's a riding time issue. But you know, especially with Davis, Davis.
Here's the deal.
He is a no nonsense.
Absolutely
right. He's an in your face kind of guy.
Exactly what he was saying was, hey, get back out there because, you know, you're giving him a break, and Terrell looks to be a little bit tired.
Yeah,
let's get back out there and get the action going. Craig pushing the pace, 8-6, 14
seconds
remaining.
Left to go, 8-6.
They sit in the north side position here. Terrell looking to
extend
his lead here. Shoves Craig out of bounds. They're moving
five,
their way
four,
back to the
four,
middle.
3.
And the match is over with 100.
1-8-6. Skylar Terrell over Anthony Craig.
Sixth-ranked Skylar Terrell looks to at least maintain his ranking at 141 pounds by defeating Anthony Craig from West Liberty by points. What was that? 8-6.
I thought that was a pretty good match.
I thought so, too. I thought Craig went out there and battled. To be honest, it extends the lead to 10-0 for Wheeling Jesuit. You know, I believe that for Jesuit to stand it, I give the – I give the upper weights advantage to West Liberty. So if Jesuit, not Jesuit, yes, Jesuit can go clean in the first half, I think that's what they need to do here. And this is going to be a test here for Preston Boshire against number three, Joel Paolo, who is a transfer from UPJ.
And that is a very great, powerful program there with Pitt Johnstown. You know, and to have Paolo come from there, obviously, very well trained, very well coached.
Absolutely. Speaking of Pitt Johnstown, Jesuit will be wrestling them here in a couple of weeks. They'll be wrestling here in Wheeling at the Jesuit McDonough Center. Pitt Johnstown will be down here for that match.
That'll be a barn burner.
Yeah, that'll be a nice match.
It's important for Boshire to not get over aggressive. Stay in the moment. Stay wrestling your match. Don't give too much to Paolo. He's a senior. He's seasoned, you know, so we got to be, you know, we want to make good, solid, smart moves.
No freebies. Don't do anything stupid or blatant.
Don't give up a six-pointer. You know what? You're not ranked. Maybe you're supposed to lose, but only lose. You know, don't give up that bonus points.
Right.
You know, Matt?
Right. Don't give up six. Give up three.
Absolutely.
You can't leave yourself hanging in a situation like that. You know, and there's a lot more to lose, you know, for Paolo than, you know, in any way, shape, or form than Boshire. You know, and this kid can, you know, I think if I were Boshire here, I'd be shooting like a wild man.
Absolutely.
Why not just go at him and be aggressive?
Nothing to lose.
Try to dig
nothing
in and get doubles. Try to get in and get underhooks. Try to get some sort of advantage.
Absolutely. But
don't be careless, but be aggressive.
Exactly. I'm thinking controlled aggression. They've been head-to-head center of the mat for majority of the first period. 1:43 remaining in the running clock in the right upper right part of your screen.
These guys look like a couple of heavyweights in there.
Yeah.
The driving, headbutts, looking for some inside position, pushing the head back
down.
Off.
Some
and we know, you know, seeing Boshire earlier in the season, we know he's got big move potential with the win over Otterson Broadus. It looks as if Paolo is just stalking, head down.
That's exactly what
like
I was going to say. Yeah,
being cerebral, waiting for an opening.
Oh,
whoa,
what a good spin-around takedown there.
Nice! Two!
Oh, I think he gave a quick.
Oh, there's back points. What do we got?
Oh, that was a quick two. He may want to wipe that off. He may be wiping that off.
That's two. He didn't give him back points,
did he? Give him the two? Did he give him?
I don't agree with the two back points.
I don't think they're conferring about the back points. I think they're talking about the takedown. But listen, in college, there's no reaction time. In college, there's no reaction time.
That's two for a takedown.
Now, in college, they can contest it.
Now, we are under further review here.
Are they going to watch a replay?
Yes.
Now what are the NCAA – are those just basic NCAA rules?
Absolutely.
Now, what are the basic NCAA rules for wrestling in as far as reviews are concerned?
Division I, they're identical. I believe that you have two per match, like per dual meet. You can use two you have two review –
throw the red flag.
Yes.
is that an option, or is this the rep – now, as you
– have
would
to ask
called
for it.
The
you
referee's to, challenge.
Well, it would be a coach's –
go back to the booth, if
right,
you will.
Because – the ref wouldn't – if I'm a ref, I'm not challenging myself.
Right.
You know, I've never made a bad call ever.
Sure.
You know? But, you know, it has to be, you know, a coach's challenge. A coach – you know, you would have to come up and say, hey, I want you to check. But it's got to be specific. What am I looking for? If you're saying, was there not back points, I'm not looking for the takedown. You know what I mean?
I thought he had a takedown. I thought he had the takedown.
Well,
the back points I thought were questionable, but I thought he had the takedown.
Man, was that was an impressive shot.
Absolutely.
He spun around backwards, grabbed him, flung him to the mat.
I've very rarely seen a double leg takedown.
That it's ever worked.
It's never worked.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, that's what he's looking for. I believe that he's looking for the takedown.
Right. That's what I think as well.
What I've noticed during just what I saw, the positioning I felt of the takedown was there. I didn't think they had any part of their body inside of the cylinder. That's what I don't think. So I don't know if it was a line call or the takedown altogether.
So we'll find out here in a minute. Buzzy Evans is giving his perspective on the review down there.
So we welcome everybody in here to the Cardinal Cast. We are at the McDonough Center live on the campus of Wheeling Jesuit University, where we have this an absolute to say it's a rivalry may be an understatement. We are developing something. We are developing something that could be get that. Quite frankly, Rick, get
Scott
Nolte
from WPRF. What we like sevens here.
This is. I've been to some matches where they've had a good crowd. I've never seen fans have to sit in the upper side of
the top bleachers
of the gym.
Right.
And what a great thing, you know. Matt wrestling, being our Wimpy Warrior, you've been to some big matches where they packed it in. Division II school, second year as a wrestling team, they're bringing a crowd like this every time Sean has.
Here comes the call. Here we go. Let's see what they say.
after the video review. He's taking neutral. Away the takedown, and we're going
away the
neutral.
Yep, we're 0-0.
All right, we are zeroed up with a 1:09 remaining in period number one. This is Joel Paulo from West Liberty University. He ranks number 3 at 149 pounds, and he takes on Wheeling Jesuits unranked Preston Bosher, who Rick and Scott have seen this season. And you say the big throw potential is there.
Yeah.
Why not? Why not? If Paulo is just going to wrap up with him and he wants to sit on a head, he's obviously trying to set up for that double leg takedown. If I'm Bosher, I'm not only sprawling like a wild man, I'm doing everything I can to get inside.
Absolutely.
And get an underhook somewhere and shrug down and try to take advantage of his over-aggressiveness.
He may not have bought the pancake takedown series video from Dr. Bill Walker.
Second edition?
Second edition. Oh, what a great shot!
That was a great double leg.
He's in
deep. That's two. Get there.
Bosher's in deep.
He's got him on his hip. He just got to get that leg back.
Get that leg out. Traffic. Paulo's
a strong kid. He needs to drive that leg in. 10 seconds. 8, 7, 6. Get behind him.
He may have it.
We have nothing.
He may have
the leg.
He's got 2 seconds. Nothing yet.
That's it.
That's a great call, by Coach.
We got. We get 0. We give him 2.
And Coach Aspas.
We got 0-0. I tell you what, Bosher, I thought he was close. I thought he had that 2 points right there. He was in deep, turned it over, laced the legs at the end, but they got a no call. 0 seconds on the clock. We're ready to start the second period.
An absolute dynamite atmosphere here at the McDonough Center on the campus of Wheeling Jesuit University. And this is obvious, honestly, something that may be mirrored to that coach's, the cancer research classic that
Absolutely.
Comes here every year. That's the type of crowd we have here
right.
tonight for a Wheeling Jesuit.
And you know what
West
else I'd like to
event.
Point out, Matt? We have Scott Nolte from WTRF TV7 out here getting some coverage on this live outstanding collegiate wrestling in the Wheeling Jesuit McDonough Center. That's just outstanding in my
mind. Ricky, all that means we've made the big time, brother.
That's right.
It. Once again,
we have made the big time.
That's it. Finally. it's been too long.
It's been 2 long years.
So here we go. Just to point out that West Liberty had the choice. They chose to defer, and Wheeling Jesuit chose to go
on bottom, trying to work out of an escape there.
He's got a really nice cross. Looking to get some wrist control.
A spiral ride
there.
He's got a deep cross ride, and he's working across that opposite elbow there. He's up on the neck.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. He was looking to cross over and maybe get a wrist and try to turn over. You can obviously see.
Now he switched the other side. Wrist controls, tight waist, breaking down. Paolo's riding him nice and tight on top, trying to stretch him out, get the arms out.
Well, now it's ride time, baby.
Yes.
Uh-huh. He's up 46 seconds on the ride time with 1:13 to go in the second period. But once again, we go back to the point that we talked about earlier in the match.
And he's out. No riding time, and he's out.
1 point escape. How about that?
That is a 57-second pretty much waste.
Yeah.
To get the 57 seconds and not get your point.
Yep.
And now this is where Bosher needs to really take advantage and
be aggressive.
He needs a takedown.
Right.
Now,
yes.
If you sprinkle the upset special under this in some way, shape, or form, That's exactly what needs to happen here for Bosher.
With two higher-ranked kids in the first 5 matches, West Liberty has got to come out with 2 wins there. You can't get swept in those being overranked, having
right.
a higher rank.
And a higher-ranked people get lose twice in the top 4 or in the first 4 matches.
And neither one of them are ranked. I mean, it's understandable
to
get a 7-4, a 7 beating a 3, but an unranked to get beat a 3 in a 5.
I'll tell you what, I think Preston Bosher is wrestling a pretty outstanding match right now.
And it doesn't look like Paolo's really pushing the pace.
I think he's being a little too lax. I think he's sitting back too much, waiting to play some defense on him and catch him in something instead of being aggressive and being the offensive person and make something happen.
I mean, I'm going to be Mr. Obvious here, but let us rewind to 2 minutes and 27 seconds roughly ago when Paolo shot in for that double leg, guys, and just kind of got the rug pulled out from under.
Sure,
right.
Does that get inside a guy's head?
Absolutely. What do you think about riding the guy, thinking you're going to turn him on his back, and then boom, he's up on his feet.
So
he's
now
winning 1-0.
So now he's got 2 on him.
I think it's a great decision. It's 1-1. I think this is a great decision because if you get reversed, you're so close to giving up that next point. So an escape essentially means nothing. I like the decision to go neutral. Let's finish it out right here on our feet and see
how
it goes.
Who's going to get that first take?
That's exactly right.
Right. Who wants it? This is going to come down to the question of the day. Who wants it?
Hart.
Here I was sliding my foot away on that shot, trying to get it away from from Palo there as if I was in the middle of the match. Yeah,
I see Palo sitting back, and if I was Boshire, I would be looking at some kind of way to attack him and push the pace a little bit, because I think either his conditioning's not good or he's not feeling good in the match because he's not really done anything yet.
Well, we're still early in the season, so obviously you're going to see conditioning be a question of a couple of these guys.
Oh, yeah, I agree, but you know what? The guy you're wrestling's had the same amount of time as you have as well.
And Boshire being a freshman out of Springfield, Ohio, very early in his college career, with Paolo, who is a redshirt senior, I believe. You know, he's sticking right in here. I like to see I like the spunk and the
fight. Is this one of the kids that came from Ohio?
Yes.
Ohio University, the kid from Westlake?
No, he came from UPJ.
Okay, yeah, that's right. You're right. That's right.
We're neutral in the center of the mat. We're tied at 1-1 with 58 seconds to go in the third period. We have Preston Boshire from Willing Jesuit versus number 3, Joel Paolo from West Liberty. It's going to come down to the last 40 seconds. Who can get a takedown here, gentlemen?
You know what? And Boshire is just staying active. He is you could just see it, Ricky, just hunting him
yes.
down.
There
he's
is.
Just
there's
waiting
another
for
shot.
His opening.
Nice shot.
And he's
Boshire
not,
with
and
nice
he's
shot.
Not standing back from shooting on
absolutely.
The
absolutely. And I like that he's taking a shot, missing, and getting the heck out of Dodge.
Absolutely.
So that's what you got to do. Don't stay underneath there.
If it ain't there, get out.
And I can tell you what, he also knows that he doesn't want to be locked up with Paolo. I can tell you that
I wouldn't
much.
Be surprised to see a slide by right here. Judging what his big
or an ankle pick. You know, he's leaving that right ankle back there a lot of times.
Not only is he leaving that right ankle for the pick, but he's also being very overly aggressive in the leaning forward, trying
right.
to it could get
shrugged down, slide by, yeah, shrugging a slide or something like that.
And here we go, gentlemen. 9 seconds.
Nine seconds. 1-1. But we got the 57-second ride
time. Is not a factor at this time.
Why is that? Because it's under a minute.
Yes.
Okay. Wow. Yeah.
And they're just going to go. They're going to stay right here, and they're going to go. They're going
to
go
overtime.
Don't.
Okay. Here we go. Overtime.
We are headed to overtime. At 149 pounds as third ranked Joel Paola from West Liberty looks to hold on here and pull out an overtime win over Wheeling Jesuits Preston Boshire.
I think Preston Boshire's already won. From a personal standpoint, he's taking the number 3 person in his region, taking him into overtime 1-1.
Here we go. Riding time's erased, gentlemen.
Yeah, but just like in every other sport, there are no moral victories, Scott.
Absolutely.
I can assure you of that.
I
can tell you that Boshire
He wants it on his record, absolutely. He's like any other competitor, man. He wants to go out there and he wants to leave the mat knowing that, you know what, I won. Even
and
if
I can
it's 2-1 or 1-0.
I can assure you also this is not where Boshire wants to be, Rick. He does not want to be tied up. He does not want to be tied up and leaning in any way, shape, or form. He wants to be advantageous of maybe a little bit of a tired.
Absolutely.
I'm surprised they haven't called a stalling on Paolo yet. He hasn't. I don't think he's shot maybe one time this whole match.
Well, you know what? You got to think, what is the advantage? None in this match. But with J.D. Ramsey, a former assistant coach for Willing Jesuit, now with West Liberty University, which is his alma mater, you know, is that going to come into play, you know, in some matches where he knows the wrestlers from Wheeling Jesuit, he knows their tendencies? I don't know. We got 7 seconds remaining in this first sudden death overtime.
Now, as you say, so do they go to the ride out now?
They'll go to top and bottom. They'll do this twice. They'll go a minute neutral, 30 seconds top bottom, 30 seconds top bottom, then another minute of sudden death, 30-30, and at the end of that, whoever has the most riding time from overtime will be declared the winner.
Wow.
So we now head to overtime period number 2.
What's the point differentiation for the teams? 3 if he wins?
Yes.
Okay.
We don't want to give up a reversal here because
that ends it. Does that end it, Rick?
No, you keep going. Boshire will have the opportunity. Now, this is the difference in college. Once he gets him up off the mat like that, if he's walking off the mat, okay. If he allows him to walk off the mat, that's a technical violation.
There are no potential dangers.
Not in college in that position.
So would Paolo be at fault for walking off the mat?
Absolutely. He'd be evading the mat. It's a technical violation.
Right.
And 12 seconds.
Boshire wins this ride on top. I think he's got the advantage.
I think he definitely does. But let's not forget.
5 seconds.
57 seconds of riding time went to
he gets one point.
Paolo as well.
Right. He gets an escape. He wins.
If escape.
Escape wins the match.
And I can tell you what, they might have to go back to the well here. My infamous sit out, turn in.
Sit out, turn in.
That might be the W
for all the marbles. He's up on his feet. He's trying to get away. Preston Beauchamp looking for that one-point escape. He's turning.
Is that it?
There's one. There's your winner.
Well, they'll keep wrestling for 20 seconds. Okay. They'll keep wrestling for the remainder of the period. 18, neither man's been hit by stalling.
Beauchamp looks like upset special in the house.
Oh, he's
ready. 18 seconds away.
They're back in the center of the mat. And 11 seconds.
And assistant coach and UFC veteran Brandon Hinkle almost out onto the mat there, maybe to tag in real quick.
Right. 4 seconds. 3, 2, 1. There's your upset of the night.
That's a big win there.
A massive upset as Preston Beauchamp from Wheeling Jesuit is upset number third ranked in the region, Joe Paolo from West Liberty. And that extends the lead for Wheeling Jesuit.
Now, Jesuit's undefeated now through the first four matches.
Here's my highlight match, Dom Nania, David Schleiper.
Now, with no further ado, we go right to 157 pounds. Dom Nania, the Rick Welker wrestler of the night, as he takes on Dave Schleiper.
From Cameron, West Virginia. Now, both these kids are big.
From Cameron?
Yes, these kids are both big moves. You know, I've seen a lot of Schleiper in high school. They're big move guys. They like to go for them big five-pointers. So the actions, you know, like we talked about earlier, 21-18 was one of Dominic's losses.
Right, yeah.
He wrestles for 7 minutes nonstop. See?
Right.
Already told you that's what he would.
He's looking for a throw and three. Oh, look at that. Nice. There's a – oh, wait a minute. Get the head. Keep it. Keep the head. Oh, he lost it. There's two. David Schleiper. They give Schleiper two.
Yes.
Schleiper with a takedown over Nania, leading 2-0 with 2 minutes and 14 seconds to go in the first period.
Schleiper maintaining top control there with Nania on the bottom and looking to obtain riding time as he's 20 seconds in, 2 minutes remaining in period number one, and Schleiper holds the 2-0 lead.
I just like to point out, look at the way he's riding him compared to the last match or so we saw. He is all over him. He is tight. He's got a tight half Nelson in on him. He's tightening up the waist on him. He just looks good on top. Schleiper
does.
Absolutely.
You're right, Scott. Now I can see, you know, obviously where you're coming from there, that he was riding, that the other guys were riding too high. It's a nice, tight waist.
Real tight. Nice, tight half Nelson. Almost had him turned over.
And you know what? I'm perfectly okay with letting him up there, too.
Sure.
Because Schleiper, it's obvious that, you know, this one's going to end up back on the mat in fast time anyway. I don't think that 1 point's going to really suffice of anything.
No, and it was a great, you know, scruffle or whatever you want from back and forth. Once again, Schleiper in under an underhook. He wants a big move. He's a big move kid, and that's what he's going for. And realistically, I think Dom is very fortunate that it was only a 2-pointer because it very easily could have been five.
Yeah, it could have went either way.
Absolutely.
It was 5 points either way. They were teeter tottering, and it just ended up that Schleiper come out on top there.
2-1, 57 seconds remaining, 47 seconds of riding time for David Schleiper. Once again, he attacks. He's going underhook as soon as he gets a chance.
There you go.
Nania goes to a front headlock. Schleiper in on a single. He's got him up in the air, and he's lifting straight
Schleiper
to his back.
Takedown straight to the back. We're counting back points. We had a two count. What is that, two of them?
He can get a fall out there. He just can't get back points.
He got three.
He got
three back
five.
Points. We now have a score of 6-1. David Schleiper from West Liberty over Dominic Nania of Wheeling Jesuit University.
Riding time seems to be the story of this match here as Schleiper holds a 6-1 lead as Scotty just went through there with 15 seconds remaining in period number one. Schleiper looks like he's going to maintain a pretty solid lead at 6-1 over Nania. Again,
eight
Schleiper from Cameron, West Virginia out of West Liberty University, and Dom Nania. Representing Wheeling Jesuit here.
6-1 after first period. You know, Nady is going to have to get something going.
Oh, yeah. But like you said, he's a big move guy. 5 points could happen right now. I mean, we've seen it twice now. Could have went either way. It just so happened that Schleiper was the more aggressive and had the better position. He ended up with a 6-1 lead. You know, who knows? Maybe reverse, maybe he'll escape
and
take down.
And the score should
right
be 7-1, actually, for two takedowns.
There it is. He's got it.
Three
he just
backs.
Corrected it. Trying to stand up. Schleiper's riding him tight. Little rollover. He's riding him as tight as you can get, man. He's on him as tight as you could possibly get.
Schleiper holding onto a tight waist here as Nania posts up, looking to maybe try to get out of there and power his way out. But now he squeezes back in.
Schleicher changes sides.
Schleicher's just kind of
rolled around and got out. Got an escape.
This kind of has the look to me, Rick, like the old 15, you know, the old 18-3 matches.
Absolutely.
In high school. You know exactly what I'm talking about.
Absolutely.
It kind of just rolls out. Rolls out of having top control. Yeah, I'm fine with being in neutral. I have all control that I'm going to be able to get you back on your back.
Absolutely.
And I'm going to build these points up. And I think that, you know, Schleicher seems to be a hit or miss. You said there's big moves.
No, that's a nice move there. Makes
nice
it 7-4.
That was
a nice move. You see these big move guys, and they're either one or the other guys. They're either Daniel the guys
take down,
going.
Trying to get some back points. He's got to hold on. It's going to be a technique. It's going to be
looking
a defensive
like
fall.
He could be getting a fall here. Schleicher looking to maintain control. But now Nania looking to sneak out the back door.
What do we got going
on? We have
on
a reversal here,
reversal
ladies and gentlemen.
Two, three back points. What's the score?
And Nania is back in this one. It's 6-12.
Yeah, that was crazy.
The scoreboard took a while to catch up there. It's now 12-6 in favor of Schleicher. He's
right.
now regained.
They were both pinned for a second.
He's now regained his 6-point control he had 18 seconds ago. Right?
Absolutely.
In a matter of 12 seconds, the scoreboard went crazy.
Unbelievable. That's why these guys are nonstop.
Right. That's where you get your 21-18.
And they are begging. The coaching staff at Wheeling Jesuit is begging Nania to shoot for that single. That Schleicher is just begging for him to take that lead
right.
And he won't take it.
There you go.
Nania looking to shrug him off, and it looks like
it's
going to cost him.
Oh, there he's got him.
He has a turnover.
He's got him.
He has him on his back.
Oh, back.
He may be in trouble here.
9 seconds to pin him.
He may be in trouble.
It could be over. What do we got? We got a 5-point move.
That five banger's booing
around.
He got the five banger. That's right, Ricky.
There it is. I'll tell you what, Nania's right back in this match, Rick. This is anybody's ball game.
I told you.
Who wants it, boy?
I told you.
Outstanding. If you ain't seeing this match, you're missing out on some amazing wrestling right now.
The Hardy star on this cup even believed me, but you two didn't.
Yeah. Heck yeah. We have an 11-13 match. David Schleicher out of West Liberty leading Dominic Nania from Wheeling Jesuit going into the third period.
Dom Nania on top here looking to maintain on Schleicher. He has the back referee's control. He's also looking to grab a tight waist.
Oh, he just
he's got to let him in there.
Move to the front headlock. Looking to obtain a double underhook there. He's got underhooks on one side. He's looking to get on the other. All he needs to do is spin around, maintain it back to his
position.
He's
going for a cradle.
He's going for the cradle. It's cradle. It's cradle.
He's back behind him.
He's got him under. He's got that minute under. He's got
a minute 33 left in the third period. Score 11.
I don't understand why Nania wasn't on him there. Looking to pull back.
He's trying to pull that same move he did where he rolled him over and kicked him up over his head and almost pinned him.
14-11, 1:21 remaining on the running clock. Jesuit Dominic Nania is down 3. Third period, the David Schleicher.
Behind him, there's
two.
He just got a takedown. It's 14-13.
Now he's got a score. He's down 1. Now's the time. What do you do here? You
still
can't
has
get the
time.
Ride time.
You can't get the ride time.
Well, he's got a pick, and he might, you know. And I like Nania. I like the game plan here. To just let him up.
Let him up. Go.
Let him up. And let's go back neutral.
Right,
like
this
more.
Could
get
score
behind
here.
Him. Get behind him. That's
now
it.
It's
That's
a tie
tie
score.
Ball game. Nania tied it up with 52 seconds left to go to third. 15-15.
This is coming down to the last 45 seconds here, ladies and gentlemen.
He's letting him up. He's going for the win. He's going for the win.
Schleicher's winning 16-15.
I would have done the same thing.
Oh,
but he can't give it up like that.
No. Keep a hold of the head. Oh!
Oh, no!
No!
Oh, no. He
pulls back. We're going to take down.
He's on top.
Nania's
and the
on up top 17-16 with 27 seconds to go. You talk about a barn burner. This has been amazing.
Nania looks like
great
he's
match.
To maintain. I'm afraid he may be called for stalling here. He needs to stay
he's
active
got a free
there.
One. He's got
something.
A free one.
Yeah, right. He's got two,
and
right?
It doesn't look like Schleicher's making any
he
effort
ain't.
To Schleicher's get up
tired.
On this match. 12
he was tired
left.
12 seconds ago.
He's been beat.
8. 7, 6, keep a hold of him, 5,
keep that high
4, Nania's going to pull off the upset. He's going to beat him 17-16.
Willie Jesuit is going into halftime, winning
undefeated.
16-0, and it's exactly the scenario that Coach Doyle spoke to me about earlier this week. He couldn't have scripted it any better.
Absolutely amazing.
16-0 going into the break.
Great match. That was a
16-0 lead for Wheeling Jesuit. The McDonough Center, you can cut the tension with a knife. It is a big rivalry matchup. The Jesuit Cardinals lead 16-0 over the Hilltoppers of West Liberty University.
Outstanding match.
over 400,000 NCAA student athletes. And just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports. There are over 400,000 NCAA student athletes. And just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports. There are over 400,000 NCAA student athletes, and just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports. There are over 400,000 NCAA student athletes. And just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports.
All right, and we're back here live at the McDonough Center, live on the campus of Wheeling Jesuit University. We are here for the battle of the gladiators, if you will. Matt Antonucci here for Cardinal Cast alongside my broadcast partner, Rick Welker, also Scotty Jackson, making his way back to the booth here. We are at 165 pounds. Wheeling Jesuit, rather, holding a 16-0 lead after an absolute insane match at 157 pounds, which saw Dominania take care of business.
Listen, and let me tell you, Matt, I'll introduce you to me. Such a good kid, too. And that's how he wrestles. He wrestles hard. And Schleiper, I knew it was going to be a match like that. I knew it was going to be big moves. I knew it was going to be a lot of points. We're talking, 31 points scored in the match, and you can't beat that. And at 165 pounds, we're, like you said, Matt, we're underway with Well Brown, I'm sorry, and Antsberger of West Liberty University.
Antsberger comes in to the McDonough Center with a number three ranking in the region at 165 pounds. So obviously, Wall Brown will have his work cut out for him here. But just like every other match here so far, Rick, from the Wheeling Jesuit side of things, it has been nothing but tough wrestling.
Absolutely.
From Coach Doyle's boys. And what did I say this evening on the Rick Welker Show, 6 to 7 on AM 1600 WKKX? You can hear it Wednesday nights only. What did I say? What was going to have to happen if these certain upsets were going to come? And that's tough wrestling, nonstop, keep fighting.
Absolutely.
Shooting the double legs, getting inside it, trying to get the wrist, trying to get the Russians, trying to maintain something. And, Wall Brown is going to take no exception here at 165 pounds as Scott Jackson rejoins the broadcast booth here.
How about that last match, guys? That was pretty exciting, huh?
I'm still trying to come down from it. I don't think 5 minutes was enough.
Yeah, right. Try to digest all that in 5 minutes, it's kind of hard to do.
We pace back and forth here in the neutral position. Both men are tied up here in the middle of the mat. Looks as if Wall Brown is looking to try to get that, hit that shrug to a single. If he's going to let this guy, if he's going to lock up with Antsberger, that's going to be the case here. He's going to try to get that tough shrug on the left-hand side and try to shoot for a single.
Yeah, you got to create that angle. You got to get a little bit of an angle on it. Well, there's a nice double leg.
Good defense.
That was a great defense.
And you know what? Takedown defense comes from the hips, comes from the leg area. That's not exactly an upper body thing to get in there and have great takedown defense. Great takedown defense, guys. Great takedown defense is great instinct and super, super control of the hips. The hips, how you people used to say, the feet shoulder width apart.
Absolutely.
That perfect just driving hips.
Absolutely. Couldn't have said it better myself, Matt. I mean, and it was a great defense there. We go into the second period.
Period number two, scoreless. It looks like Wall Brown is going to be on the bottom. Antsberger on top. He's driving a high waist.
Trying to post it up.
Absolutely. A nice post up there by Wall Brown.
It looks like he's trying to work the hands out.
With the big
picked
slam.
Him up and slammed him.
The big slam. We go back back to the top position for Ansberger, where he looks to see be doing basically whatever he wants. And unfortunately, Walbrown has just kind of stomached out, if you will, as it goes.
But Matt, you got to look at the bright side. If you're Walbrown, the score is 0-0. He's manhandling, but he hasn't given up any points yet. So,
Scotty, I can assure you from being in situations like this, wrestling guys that are ranked higher than you, there is no good position the whole night. Walbrown able to escape, maintains his first lead of the evening at 1-0 with 1:10 remaining in the second period. And, Rick, is it just me, or is – I can really only count two leads in matches that West Liberty has had.
It hasn't been many, and I couldn't agree more. It has been two, maybe. I'm only thinking
the last
Schleifer had
a lead
for literally no longer than 12 seconds. I counted that entire match, and at 157 pounds. He did not hold on to a lead for longer than 12 seconds.
And those were the two leads you were talking about. Right. I can't think of another wrestler from West Liberty having a lead at all.
And that's it almost seems to a point where could we be inside the heads, and we, being the Wheeling Jesuit, we be inside the heads of West Liberty?
Oh, I would absolutely think so. Right. I mean,
you're on home court here too, Rick, so that has a lot to do with it.
Absolutely. Well, and you got little brother heckling you, you know, and mom's standing there and you can't hit him. Right. That's what it is.
And it looks as if Ansberger shoots tight in on a single.
Walbrown,
but a nice ball.
Another
nice
great defense.
The takedown defense of Reese Walbrown, up to this point, has been absolutely impeccable. A+, and just another notch in the cap for head coach Sean Doyle.
Yeah. You can't give him enough credit. I mean, his wrestlers are sound.
I don't know if I could give Coach Doyle any more credit throughout the course of the evening than just that right there. The takedown defense of Walbrown has been absolutely impeccable, A+.
Well, and you know I like is that you can see that they're well-trained. You know, they're well-trained. They're very, very poised for a young wrestling team. I mean, the oldest kid on the team is a sophomore.
And you know what?
Right.
You know what? Where I could see that from, Ricky, and call me the psychiatrist of the situation, but when I see a kid who's constantly looking over at his coach,
right,
that's not right upstairs.
Right.
That is a mental setback. And you see these kids from Wheeling Jesuit, you don't see a whole lot of kickback to Coach Doyle, and maybe what should I do here? Where are my options? What
Absolutely.
Do I do? These guys know what to do.
They allow them. You know, Sean's allowing them to make decisions. You know, go wrestle. That's how you got
situational
here.
Wrestling.
Right.
And that's such a huge deal.
The way I see it like that is Doyle wouldn't have him on the mat if he didn't have confidence.
Sure.
And I think he feeds that to them. He's like, you've been trained, you've been in the wrestling room all this time, last year, this year. Your time's been put on the mat. When you get out there, it's your 7 minutes, okay? Go out there and do the best that you can in that 7 minutes, and I trust that you'll do the best that you can. You're gonna win a lot, but there's gonna be some times you lose. But you know what? If you go out there and do what we've trained you to do in the wrestling room, you're gonna do all right.
It's a real simple finish.
And here we are, guys. 45 seconds remaining here, Matt. You know, we got the 1-1 tie here. Riding time is not a factor.
Not a factor, and only 33 seconds in.
Get on him. There's two.
That's the two.
That's aggressiveness and hustle. It's going to win the match for him. And I think the Wheeling Jesuit University has been the most aggressive and the most hustling people in this match already tonight.
Now, you got to be thinking here, give up one, not two.
We're going to go back to the Nania match, and you can just kind of – it's okay if you let him up here.
Right.
Yeah, you have 30 seconds left. Give him 1 point. Don't give him two.
Well, you know what? At the same time, you have 25 seconds left until the riding point comes to Walbrown. So, I mean, that's the 1 point that he may need. So maybe Coach Doyle's saying that we need to hold that ride time, which ride time is still clicking with control here for Walbrown. He has 10 seconds left until that riding time point comes to him, and we still have it at 7-6. He's holding a tight single there, trying to maintain. West Liberty looking
neutral.
For a stall.
Four seconds.
Again, this is the third or fourth time I've seen Brandon Hinkle make his way onto the mat and complain about stalling. Where's the separating factor in the stalling department from the referee's perspective?
Well, you know, to me, are you making an attempt to take him to the mat? Are you making an attempt to prove your position?
And he was
Which
working
he
his
was.
Way up. And then it looks as Walbrown's going to give him the voluntary diamond diamond snap, we used to call it, the voluntary release there, which will give him
another
one point, which will give him the 1 point lead with no time remaining, and that will be how this ends. One more point added to Jesuit score, 17-0 lead over West Liberty, and the win for Wall Brown. What was the final?
It was three to two, and it's another unranked wrestler. It's another unranked wrestler beating a ranked wrestler.
Three times now.
Yes. You cannot lose these matches, guys. You can't.
Right. And you know what it comes back to? Like I said, from match one, West Liberty looks like they're out there just trying not to make a mistake, while Willing Jesuits putting forth the effort, putting the energy into it, and being the aggressor.
We have our first double ranked matchup, if you will, as second ranked Sawyer Lepla from Wheeling Jesuit will defend his second rank against sixth ranked Jordan Nolan from West Liberty. And this is one of your favorites here in Nolan.
I think that this is going to be a highly contested match. I think it's, you know, Lepla's just getting down to 174. He's been wrestling 184 all year. Jordan Nolan is a highly decorated wrestler, a high school wrestler out of West Virginia. I think this is a great matchup. I think this one can go either way. And Lepla is, you know, we've seen him wrestle a few times. This is our first time to see Jordan in a while. But I think this is going to be a solid match here, Matt.
They're both being pretty aggressive inside, you know, trying different angles, trying different things, you know, tying up with the head, shooting him with a single leg. But it's one of those things, Rick. You know, who's going to be the aggressor? Who's going to go out there and try to make something happen? And instead of sitting back on their haunches.
For a single, he's got it in deep. Nolan hopping on 1 foot, trying to get out of bounds to try to get this back neutral. We are close, ladies and gentlemen. And Lepler is about a step away from getting this takedown here, but he maintains the single and gets back down to the ankle pick to try to maintain the back end. But it looks like the old crutchy move from Jordan Nolan. And it looks, who has the takedown there?
Coach Doyle needs the challenge yet.
And Coach Doyle's latest came off. And I'm a little confused on why.
I believe the referee, Fred Feeney, thought he had a Merkle in.
He's going right to the computer, and we are going to get a challenge here, ladies and gentlemen.
I think it's a good challenge.
At 1:35 into period number one, no time wasted whatsoever to get things. And like I said, Coach Doyle went from 0 to 35 in about a matter of a nanosecond, and he stormed right to the table.
And I've seen 0 to 35, but it wasn't a nanosecond.
That's pretty fast.
That's pretty quick.
Yeah, I know.
That's cheetah quick.
Yeah. Like I said,
that's Doyle quick.
I literally saw Coach in a seat, and then when they made their way over, and Lepla had the single leg and was going to turn over, and then when Nolan got, the old crutchy move, the front headlock to try to turn around the other way, he was out of his seat faster than I think I've seen anybody move, especially me, this big guy.
Absolutely. And I'll tell you what, if I'm assuming that the rule is the same in college, where if he's in on a Merkle, he's got to have a leg. You got to have 3 points of control.
Oh, the old Merkle.
Right. I think that's what Sean's saying, is he didn't have that leg.
He didn't have the leg. He had the head and the arm, but he didn't have the leg.
So right now what's being reviewed, if you will, is whether or not Lepla was able to get the takedown. He was pretty much working his tail off.
Well, I think what they're looking at is to see if Nolan had secured 3 points of control.
And they're done. It was a pretty quick decision, so let's see what they have to say. They're coming back to the center of the mat.
He said that he got it.
There it is.
So that'll be our first overturn of the evening. And Nolan from West Liberty will maintain a 2-0 lead, but he lets Lepla up. Rather easily.
And that was just great defense by Jordan Nolan on that takedown.
Mm-hmm. We're back to face-to-face here, right in the middle of the mat, pacing back and forth, looking to gain control.
Tying up with the heads, trying to get some hand control. We got a lead of 2-1. Jordan Nolan out of West Liberty University. And they're just trying to feel each other out, trying to get an angle on somebody here, trying to get a takedown.
Looking to get maybe a double arm. He's got his double underhook, so he's looking to maybe get one. I think the other one was kind of gifted to him by Nolan. Now they work back to the edge of the mat again. And Nolan looking to scave the old keep the 2 foot in, drag him, the drag move from Nolan there. But to no avail, still 2-1 lead for Nolan, though, from West Liberty. They back to the center of the mat. Probably going to be.
Lepla keeps stepping backwards. I don't know if the referee's going to see that, but he needs to start stepping forward and being the aggressor here. They blow the whistle. He steps backwards.
And that stalling call may be the difference in the match.
Well, let's point something out, guys. You know, I didn't mean to interrupt you there, but if Lepla wins this match, essentially the dual meet is over because they'll have a 22-point lead with eight
and
matches
they can't
remaining.
There'd be no way possible for them to come back.
Correct.
Right.
Not even with five straight pins.
Right.
Locked up back again there in the middle of the mat. Lepla looking to try to maybe get a shook shrug down there.
Almost an ankle pick.
I was going to say, almost had the ankle there, Scotty. And now again, just absolutely, just with a dead stare, you could tell that Lepla is looking for the opening, looking for the options. And Nolan just seems to be slamming the door on everything possible.
But end of the period. We have 2-1 going into the second period?
Second period, yes.
Second
sir.
Period, 2-1.
Lepla chooses to go down, which is usually, like I said, from my perspective, I always like to choose to go down first.
Right.
That would always – just so if it was going to come to that, it was going to come to the one escape point, and I was more than willing to have him give it to
absolutely.
Him.
2-2. And as you said, he got out rather easily. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Lepla looking with that north-south control headlock there, front headlock style.
2-2, back in the center of the mat.
And I can already dive in Lepla's game plan right now. He's waiting for Nolan to give it to him.
Sure.
He's waiting for Nolan to give him the options, and everything that he's gotten, Nolan has given it to him. So from Coach Davis's main perspective now from on the West Liberty side of things, you have to tell
nice
Nolan
shot.
Out there, don't
take
give
him
it
down.
Him.
Get him to the mat.
That's
Lepla gets him down. There's two. He's winning 4-2 now. Lepla over Jordan Nolan.
Now a 4-2 lead here. Now he's looking to maintain and hold on to riding time as there's 5 seconds left in his riding time. He can easily, and that's the bonus point, the gimme point, Rick. Just
right.
Let him have it. You know, you got 5 seconds left. You hold on tight. You get your riding point. And then I think now with the 3-point lead, I think that really kind of changes the situational wrestling there.
Oh yeah, and I really felt earlier in the match when Nolan was able to secure a takedown, I felt that I felt that Lepla just got out of position. I don't think he did anything wrong. We just and I like this idea of letting him go there, and he went out on the edge of the mat there. You know, his foot come off the mat. I like the call, even though Lepla was in deep and he could have scored it out there. I think it's the right call by the official because.
Somebody
you know,
could
he's
get hurt.
Off the mat, yeah.
Somebody could get hurt.
Now, if you notice, Jordan Nolan was grabbing his groin area. But the problem is, in college, you get hurt one time. The first time you're injury time, the other person gets choice. So you have
so
to.
You can't
take it.
You don't do like in high school where
correct.
Sometimes it's advantageous to get the blood time and
correct.
Get it. Or the injury time.
Correct.
Blood time injury.
30 seconds to go in the second period, 4-3.
And you know what? I
Sawyer Lepla winning over Jordan Nolan.
And you know what? You don't see it in the score, Scotty. You don't see it in the score. But I think Lepla has the absolute total advantage going into period number 3 for Wheeling Jesuit. At 15 seconds remaining, he still holds that 1-point lead.
Absolutely.
Not only is Nolan showed obvious weakness in being hurt, he's every single time and every single big move moving forward that has been made has came from the side of Sawyer Lepla.
Uh-huh.
And like I said, this is our first both sides being ranked match of the evening.
Match. Yeah,
and
right.
It's given us everything that we had hoped for.
Absolutely.
With 5 seconds remaining, Lepla looks to maintain
his riding time.
I was going to – exactly. If you,
okay. Oh, I'm sorry.
He had five seconds left to get his ride time point.
Okay.
Now we keep climbing here. Now if he gets another 2 minutes, Rick, is that another point?
If he gets to 1 minute on riding time,
he
gets
minute,
a point.
Yeah. Okay. 1 minute. And he's got a nice tight half in there. He's got his spiral ride going on, trying to work around to the left side, breaking down flat. That's Sawyer Lepla there working with the half, trying to break Nolan down to the mat, maybe turn him over, get some back points here. He's going to call a warning for a stalling. The ref is.
Well, and
Nolan,
to say that
to
Nolan.
Nope, Nolan's working hard to get out. He keeps standing up, but Lepla keeps taking him back to the mat.
Well, He's riding tight. I have a feeling that
we're
with an injury here. I think from Nolan's perspective. We are riding the side here, and it looks like there was a reversal here for Jordan Nolan.
Jordan Nolan is now winning 5-4.
Man,
That was ugly on the
edge
of the ring.
How the tides have changed.
Yes, that was ugly on the edge of the ring. Got out of control, got a little bit high on his ride, and Nolan took advantage of it and slid out from underneath of him and ended up on top. Now he's winning 5-4 with 1:03 to go in the third.
this will be the separating factor here, Rick. You know, now obviously, it's obvious
that it might come down to that ride time too, Matt.
No one is hurt, and it's obvious. I think that Leplin needs to be on top and stay on top.
It is. Can we get two? Get the leg out.
He's got at least the one.
Leplin's got at least one. He's got to pull the leg out to get two.
He's got to lock him hands up.
I can't see what's going on here. Is that Nolan going to give with a technical, with a defensive fall? What is that? What'd they give?
Three more backs. That's what's going to lock up. Leplin gave up back points as he was trying to
pin him.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's got his work cut out for him now with 25 seconds left to go.
Four. This is needless to say type stuff. Mr. Obvious checking in real quick. But we're going to need a throw, a something, a five-pointer.
A big bang.
Needs to happen here for Leppler. You know, this may be the
West Liberty.
I don't see a five beating a two as like a super upset. The upset is there, and I acknowge it and embrace it, but – six over a two.
Yep.
All right, and that looks like this will be a wrap with 10 seconds left here. Looks as if
Nolan's trying to turn him, trying to work.
I think he's just going to ride it out here.
Yeah, why not? Two, one. That's a wrap. Jordan Nolan will win this 8-4, and we'll put West Liberty on the board with three points there as Jesuit leads 19-3. And without any further ado, we head to 184 pounds, where third-ranked Ryan Winslow out of Wheeling Jesuit will take on,
Danny Doyle.
Son, or what is it?
Cousin.
That's cousin of Sean Doyle.
Right. Here we go. There's Doyles everywhere in wrestling in the Valley.
And this is the kid from Trafford, right? Is this the kid from Penn Trafford?
Yeah.
I've seen this kid wrestle before at 189 pounds, which Rick informed me tonight on his show there on WKKX AM 1600, a show you can hear on Wednesday nights, 6 to 7, only on AM 1600 WKKX. That I have seen my bit of this guy here, Winslow. Came out of Penn Trafford, the WPL area, and this kid is an absolute horse, a powerhouse. And I'll tell you that the thing that you do not want at all when you're standing up in neutral with this kid is to have him with some sort of wrist control or an underhook or to be in on a leg on you because it's over. You might as well just send it to the bank. And I think that just like here, when he has that tight front headlock, I can't tell you how many times I've seen that kid spin around and get his two.
And here's the thing, gents, just real quick, sorry to interrupt you, Scott. We need bonus points from here on out for West Liberty. Even if Doyle wins here a decision for three, they can't win the match. They need bonus points from here on out.
Right.
And it's got to be, you know, we're talking about a 16-point difference. For them to win, you're looking at a pin and a pin to make it 15, and then they need a tech fall. So anything less of
a
major decision could tie it up with pin.
Right.
So a decision doesn't do anything for them.
No, they got it. Major decision or a fall, right?
Major pin can tie it. Anything less than that, it's done.
Mm-hmm. That's a long shot. It could happen. The possibility's there, but that's a long shot in my eyes. This guy here, Ryan Winslow, he looks pretty good out there. It's just a matter of time before he starts taking advantage of the opportunities he's been given. He's been close twice already now for a takedown. But you got to give credit to Danny Doyle. He's been pretty good on the defensive side of it. But there he goes. He's shucked him down again. He's got him on the mat. He's reaching for a pick on the ankle.
And I can tell you one thing, a kid with the last name Doyle, the one thing he's not going to do is quit.
No.
Not when it comes to wrestling, Matt. The name Doyle is synonymous with wrestling in the Ohio Valley. That's just absolutely, that's a given.
Well, Winslow looking to maintain the front headlock here in north-south control, if you will. Also looking to try to gain some wrist here to try to shrug and turn and get his two, which Scotty's a testament said he's been given many opportunities. Let's see if he can take one to the bank here with 45 seconds remaining in period number one. Right. Again, Wheeling Jesuit holding a 19-3 lead over West Liberty here at the McDonough Center, the Alma Grace McDonough Center.
That's right.
Live from the campus of Wheeling Jesuit University. This is part of the Cardinal Cast broadcast. And I can't thank you guys enough for having me here. It's been
up to this point,
it's been absolutely a blast. And Winslow and Doyle locked up again here, mid-Matt. And that's Matt with one T. Looking to get a double, looking to get the double underhook here and push down.
Yeah. Winslow's done that a couple of times. Used his weight, got him in a tight front headlock, and pulled his head to the mat. He just hasn't been able to get around him. And, you know, I feel as this match goes on that he's going to figure that out because he's been close twice.
Well, I think fatigue may become a factor as we move here into period number two. No score. Looked like we're awaiting the flip of the coin here.
And it's absolutely wearing Danny Doyle down.
That's
carrying
a lot
all
of
his weight.
That's a lot of work to carry that weight. And another thing Danny Doyle did right at the end of that period, when he was trying to defend that, he stuck that left leg up when his head was on the mat. He's asking for a cradle if he does that. I mean, it's just a matter of time before Winslow picks up on that.
And Winslow's out real quick.
He's up
1-0. 3 seconds into the second period, Winslow's to his feet. They're head-to-head again. And once again, you know, going right to the head, putting that weight on the head, pressure on the head, and beating him down.
Snapped
and
him there down. There it is. There it is. He snapped him down, took care of it, and it was just a matter of time.
It was just, exactly. He was just waiting for Doyle to proportion his weight
right.
in any way, shape, or form back towards Winslow right. so he could get that snap.
Right. Winslow snapped him down four times, figured out how his defense was. He just went with a different route on the offense, snapped him down, went a different route, and he wasn't ready for him. So Doyle got the 2 point on him.
Had the spiral
the
ride, now right. running up on a tight waist. He's now got a leg there trying to maintain, but Doyle's out.
And Doyle's once again, out. Just like you said, that whip. Oh, look at that. Great shot.
Yeah,
and that's
tight.
A style. That's a stylistic. The Whippeel style ref, that's a style.
Yes. Snatch an ankle, swip around behind him.
And you could tell, and it's with the tight front headlock with a lot of the shrugs, a lot of the pull downs.
Keep that angle.
That's Whippel style wrestling right there.
And we go tied up, Scott, just like you said there.
Yeah, that was a great takedown.
Absolutely.
You know, I like the way he swung around there, snatched the ankle, picked it out from him, and then he just had to do a little work on the inside there, and he ended up getting his 2 points, tied it up 3-3. But Doyle lets him up. Now we got a tie. We got a 4-3 lead now by Ryan Winslow.
Winslow snuck a two in there, and it's now 6-3.
I love that attack.
Yeah,
me too.
Yeah, they've done it the whole time, Rick. The two matches ago, right at the edge, at the end, the guy was running, fell down out of bounds. The guy dove on him, got his 2 points, and that cost him the match.
Maybe. He took the smallest of openings from Danny Doyle, and he attacked.
He gave up an escape. His entire body's out of bounds. I'll tell you what, I'm probably relaxing there too. If I'm in Danny Doyle's position, and then here he comes, and he's not ready.
He's
for
on
it.
Top. Bang. You weren't ready. There's 2 points.
So essentially, within 2 seconds, it's a 3 point difference.
Right. Yeah.
And I've been in no danger at all to get those 3 points.
No. Mm-hmm.
Winslow's all over him now, riding on top.
And
almost
now this is going to be
he's
where
got an arm
be,
bar,
this
like.
Is going to be where it becomes a problem for Doyle. 20
Caution.
Seconds. 20 seconds remaining in riding time for Winslow until we climb, or a minute 20, I
right,
guess.
Right, so we go to
a
the
minute
point.
20 until he gets that point. 12 seconds remaining in period number three, maintains a solid 3 point lead over Danny Doyle.
I like the way Winslow's riding him. He's riding him nice and tight. He's doing a lot of work on the arms and the neck, shooting the half, you know, turning the wrist under, trying to get some kind of arm bar or something. He had him almost turned there, but the ref called a caution on him. The arm got up too high behind the back there, so it was a good call, but I like the way Winslow's working. You know, he ain't quitting. He's going out there to wrestle. He knows he's got 2 minutes left to wrestle in this match. And if he wrestles hard for two more minutes, I think he's going to pull the win out.
And now obviously the wrestler in me comes out and asks a question with someone that's being so aggressive with the post move. First thing that anybody's ever taught me, even wrestling as high up as heavyweight, is when someone tries to get that post in, do you wrap a grapevine in on the left-hand side? How come you don't see that as much anymore?
Yeah, it's just the style of wrestling I think is changing, man. I mean, they're so effective. And, you've wrestled long enough, you know, from the time from youth on up. You know, you get to youth, we teach you the doubles and the singles and the very basic things. Then you get to your club and they're teaching you mixers and things that are real gimmicky. But then you're successful with that in middle school. Then you get to high school and you start going back to basics. Then you get to college here.
So you see throwing legs in as a gimmick?
No, I think it's
no,
I think
it's
right
okay.
now.
I just wonder.
I don't think it's perfected and it's taught. And I don't think that people really understand, like, to throw those legs. There's not a lot of Kyle Dakes right now that can throw them legs in and wear you out for
And that's
minutes.
Exactly who I was going to say.
Yeah.
I've never seen and if you we were watching a Kyle Dake match right now,
right.
If he posts that left leg up and you don't see a grapevine within a half second,
right.
you don't even think you're watching a Kyle Dake
well,
match.
And
that's
and,
who I thought was seeing.
Oh, we got a
really
Winslow with a takedown. There's two more. Now his lead goes up to 8-3.
And every time I think of that was the year when Dake beat Frank Molinaro his sophomore year.
Yes.
And he rode Molinaro for 5 minutes and 26 seconds.
With the grapevine.
Absolutely.
With the grapevine tuned. With the grapevine tuned.
And he comes off the mat, and he's talking to ESPN, and he says, I rode him like a dog.
You got to love that quote, oh, yeah. Like a dog.
And then the Flow Wrestling video where it was a cartoon of Frank Molinaro saying, I choose down.
Right.
And they're like, why would you choose down? You know, you just got rode. You've been rode for 4 minutes here. Why would you choose down? But it was a cartoon that just kept saying, I choose down. I choose down. It was a little cartoon of this Italian kid.
Right. Winslow's got him, I think. We got 32 seconds left in the third period. He's winning 8-3.
Maintaining an 8-3 lead.
Over Danny Doyle. And you know
we
what?
He had the ride time point, too. We're at a minute 43 in the ride time, so he's got his ride point.
You know what? He used that front headlock pretty effectively, throwing his weight down on Doyle, getting Doyle tired, and snapping his head down
to
the mat.
Yeah. He baited him. He baited him.
That's exactly right. He baited him. He did it 4 or 5 times, defended it the sixth time. He shucked
it to the
side. And
it all comes down
to
this spot right here on the corner mat right before the end of the second period when Danny Doyle took that 8-second, not even, deep breath. Took a deep breath, and he got it. And all he had to do was take a deep breath, and it cost him 3 points.
Absolutely. Right. There's the match. They can't come back now. That's it. It's over.
Third-ranked Ryan Winslow will maintain, defeating unranked Danny Doyle 9-3, and extending West Wheeling Jesuit's lead 21-3, moving here into a match at 197 pounds. Now we're starting to get to the big boys. Well, I'm starting to like it here, Ricky. We get 197 pounds. We have sixth-ranked Maxwell Lacey out of Wheeling Jesuit. He'll take on unranked Nathan Dawson from West Liberty.
Here's my question. Did anybody foresee this? The new guys on the block coming out, and it could be 25-0.
Yes.
The match the Jesuit or that West Lib won was a very tight match.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And you know what? I would have never predicted that. I thought it was a lot closer than that. But once again, you got to go back and say kudos to the program. They're hungry.
Absolutely.
They're hungry.
If you
they
remember,
know.
Guys, I called it 21-17.
Right.
I thought it was going to be coming down.
Right.
We were talking about a heavyweight match that was going to matter.
Right.
You know,
it don't
matter.
The only
person that matters to now is Severio.
Exactly. It's pretty much over. Jesuit's got it in the bag. They can say that they're the new quote-unquote powerhouse in this matchup here because they won the last two times they've been together.
Exactly. And it's not like they just won by a little bit.
They
this
dominated.
Was a, this was a clinic.
Yeah, they
dominated.
That's
a great takedown there by Dawson.
Yep, 2-0. 2 minutes, 10 seconds to go in the first.
And this is exactly the type of thing that gets you an upset win with the big weight,
Yes.
When you start getting up to the big boys, you get that first takedown. You're starting to get into late second period, into the third period. Now we're talking conditioning.
Absolutely.
It's not even a remote amount of technique going on out there. Now, what Maxwell needs to do is he needs to take the power back.
Absolutely.
Right? He needs to shoot out like a ball of fire out of here, and he needs to take the power back.
When you got a 200-pound man on your back, that's like strapping on 200 pounds of weights and trying to do your just rolling around the mat. That's very difficult
to do. So I'm just saying I've also been in these situations before.
Very difficult.
I don't think Maxwell wants to wait around until the third period to start trying to chip back in it.
I agree. 2-1. But, hey, that was a heck of a shot by Dawson.
Oh, yeah, you got to give him credit. That was a great takedown.
Looked like a Sunday afternoon tackle is what it looked like.
It definitely did.
But effective, got the 2 points, right?
Sure, absolutely. And now this is a very stereotypical,
typical heavyweight,
if you will,
pummeling.
Of the weakness of the heavyweights, the pumbling, the head snaps.
Rolling the hands around.
Looking to maybe get that elbow to wrist control, which is what was always taught to me, elbow to wrist, elbow to wrist. And if you can work that back and forth, eventually you're going to get – control over somebody in that neutral position to where you can turn that Russian over.
There was a nice duck under. Didn't get it, but it was a nice one by Dawson.
Duck under is another one of my favorites, too.
A little slide by to a high crotcher. It's pretty slick.
Throw that elbow up in the air and get under there and grab a leg. He almost
had
it.
I would love to see Maxwell take a shot on that heavily braced right knee of not that I'm a guy who likes to shoot at guys' weaknesses, but I'll tell you what, I would definitely be taking shots at that heavily taped right knee of Nathan Dawson.
And it's funny you bring that up. It reminds me of something when I was a kid. I remember wrestling in the great late Jim Thomas, a wrestling coach or a football coach from Wheeling Central. His sons, Jimmy and Dax, were great wrestlers.
Right.
What happened was we were at a tournament. Chance Taylor, who was a
phenomenal wrestler,
he hurt his wrist. His hand was hurt, right? So Mr. Thomas goes over and starts taping his hand. Well, Chance looks at him and goes, hey, you're taping the wrong hand. He says, I know. because they're going to go after the go hand after this that they think's hurt.
Right.
And they'll leave your other one alone.
Right. That's pretty smart, huh?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Brilliant. That's brilliant. Yeah. But I want to tell you something, man. Kudos to Chance Taylor. I wrestled him a couple of times as a dummy in the wrestling room, and I mean literally dummy. He made me look like
a fool. I think he made you the JV wrestler you ended up being.
He was a phenomenal wrestler, bro.
Was that your first win?
Oh, no. No, I didn't win nothing against that dude. He put it on me. I remember one time he put me in a front headlock and rolled me over and pinned me in about 8 seconds.
I actually heard whispers of the Cardinal asking where you were when he came. When you were in the bathroom, he actually came up here and he said,
All I got to say is he wasn't here on the first match.
Right,
year.
And I heard that he had a wing injury.
Yeah. That's right.
A real serious
Let me say this. Thanks, Sean Doyle, for getting me out of that mess.
He had a buffalo sauce injury on his left wing.
Buffalo sauce injury, yeah.
I thought I was about to come out here at 43 and get hurt.
They thought they were going to be able to heal it with some blue cheese, but they couldn't get it done.
No, sir. Ranch dressing, no blue cheese.
Yeah. Maxwell here still trails 3-1, minute 25 remaining.
Oh, nice shot. Pull it in.
Maxwell's had a couple opportunities at a single leg, has just not been able to finish. And another thing, when a guy tries to mess with his headgear, I'm like a wild
attack.
Man. Wild man. If you see a guy, basically, the rule always was shown to me, if you see a guy that's got elbows above his rib cage, you go like a wild man, because you know that means. It means he's trying to mess around and jimmy around with his headgear, which is always listen to me. I'm like the dirtiest player in the game. I'm talking about going after his heavily taped knee.
Right.
Shooting in on him when he's trying to mess with his headgear.
That's all right. Anything to win, though, right, Matt?
Oh, you know.
You got to go after the win, man.
And here we go once again, center of the mat. Their hand fighting in the center. 3-1 lead for Nathan Dawson.
Maxwell has
Liberty.
Not been able to gain 1 minute of inside control on Nathan Dawson. A huge tip of the hat to him, who's coming out and really wrestling, I'm sure, wrestling the match of his life here, too.
He's wrestling a great match here. And just, you're right, Maxwell just can't seem to get in there and be effective in any way. A shot that's continually being blocked.
And Dawson's giving him those crossover throws. You know what I mean? But that's a huge risk to take.
Yeah.
Especially when you're losing 3-1.
Yeah, absolutely. If big guy drops on you, you're in bad shape. Especially going into the third period.
10 seconds remaining. Maxwell still trails 3-1 over West Liberty's Nathan Dawson. But the Cardinals are basically
dominating,
massive control at 22-3. And looks like Coach Davis, Coach Hinkle, and the Hilltoppers are looking to just, you know, stop the bleeding, if you will, with these last two matches at 197 to 85.
Try to find something positive in the whole situation and move on to next week or whoever the next opponent might be.
Do they get – how long until they get the extra – or does college have the extra pounds?
I'm not real sure when they get the extra pound. I would imagine that they probably get the pound or two.
Man, you talk about the most relieving days of your wrestling season.
The greatest 1 pound in the world
was when you got the 1 pound.
Right.
Oh, my God.
It was like 10 pounds, it seemed like.
And what the National Federation did in high school is they made it – remember how it used to be you got one and then you got another one later?
Right, right.
Now you get two on Christmas Day,
awesome.
And that's it.
That's your present. Santa. So, yeah.
Good enough present for me. Right. Well, now things are a little more interesting here as Maxwell got out of there and gave himself his 1 point.
He's got a chance.
Now trails one, and a takedown wins it here. And I can assure you, a takedown wins this match here, either for
one
Dawson
takedown,
or
right.
for Maxwell. First takedown wins, gentlemen.
You know what? I look for Lacey to take advantage of this situation. He's been hanging in the match for two whole periods. There he goes. He shot in. He's in tight. He's got a single. If he can work it around to the left side,
and you know
he's
what?
Trying to work in. And
he
Dawson's
shot in
got
on,
leg
shot
in
on that left leg, too.
Yeah. He defends it well. Dawson defends
he
it.
Needs to go again.
He needs to go
Same
again.
Go
again,
again, again,
and again,
and again, and again.
Exactly. He needs to work.
You
That's
know what?
This is going to win this match.
This is also a Matt Antonucci special right here, shooting right off the whistle.
Yes.
The whistle blows.
Shooting right off the whistle.
Right.
And Dawson's looking winded, bringing his hands up to his head as he's coming back into the mat.
Touch and go. There
That's
it is. Get the leg
That's
in.
It.
Touch and go.
Be athletic. Obviously, an athletic advantage goes to Maxwell Lacey without a shadow of a doubt. He needs to get in, and he needs to keep shooting and shooting
right.
and shooting
he
until
has,
he gets
he
his two.
He has 30 seconds, Matt. And you know what? He has to reach down deep and pull something out of the gut to get this match under his belt, because it's right there for him to take. There it is. Another one, single leg. He's in tight.
18 seconds remaining.
Dawson's defending well. He's got a double underhook. He's back up there neutral again with 13 seconds to go.
I don't understand why somebody doesn't get called for stalling for that's my issue there.
Well, finally.
Both officials know this guy's going to be backing up and trying to avoid a takedown from Lacey.
They'll do something.
7 seconds remaining.
Dawson's just too strong. It's over.
It's over.
Dawson's just too strong. And that will end it. Upsets 6th ranked, 6th seeded Maxwell Lacey out of Wheeling Jesuit. Gets the W there for West Liberty. And cuts into their trail 22-6 now as we move to heavyweight.
Right.
We go to Corey Siegfried and Aaron Silverio.
Silverio.
Aaron Silverio from West Liberty University. He'll take on Wheeling Jesuit's Corey Siegfried. And now this is where we're going to be seeing a lot of splatting in the face.
Right. A lot of head grabbing.
A lot of trying to get in on an underhook. There.
A lot of reaching. Reach down for a leg. Don't shoot.
As a coach, what do you say to a guy like Lacey after losing a match that there's something worth arguing that he shouldn't have lost? What do you say to a kid like?
Well, you just got to go in there and you got to be honest. You relaxed for a second early in the match where you don't think it's going to make a difference, and it made all the difference in the world. And that's what you got to do. You can't, losing your focus just for that second, which may have been what Lacey did there. It's a great learning tool. It's better to happen here than in a placement match at regionals, which will take you to nationals or not. So, Rick, it's a good learning tool.
I read something like that in one of the comments on the wrestlers that were posted on their website today. You got 7 minutes to wrestle. Wrestle for 7 minutes.
Right.
Not 6 minutes and 59 seconds, because
absolutely,
that 1 second, just like we saw a couple matches ago, makes a difference. And he relaxed for a second. He jumped on him. There's 2 points.
And unfortunately, like the same with Danny Duell. That match was a little bit out of hand at that point. He was down 3, but it's a quick change. 3 points gone right there, And unfortunately, it was the difference maker, Matt, in that match where it comes down to 3-2.
That'll take the wind out of your sails, too. You're down 1. You still got a chance. You got 30 seconds to go. Now you're down 3 and you got 30 seconds to go. That changes the whole ball game.
Absolutely. And we are 30 seconds into the first period here at heavyweight that pins Corey Siegfried from the Jesuit Cardinals and Aaron Silverio. This is the 5th-ranked Aaron Silverio. Man, is he a brick house or what? That Aaron Silverio from West Liberty. Wow. It just looks like an absolute powerhouse. And it seems that seems to be totally fine with embracing the heavyweight style.
Sure.
He doesn't look like your typical heavyweight. He looks like a whole lot of muscle.
That looks like a kid that could have been, Now, why is 197 and why is there no gap class between 197 and 285?
I don't know why there isn't like a 220 or something that you see in high school. And the thing is,
that's a tough separating factor.
If you're walking around
at 220 pounds,
230.
What's your better move? Is it just going all out and cutting down to 197, or do you enjoy Thanksgiving dinner,
right,
unlike every other wrestler on the planet, and just go to heavyweight?
Matt, you have demons on both sides.
Yes.
You cut that much weight, you're tired, you're physically beat, you don't have the strength that you used to have. But then if you put on that much weight and you're not used to having it, you're in the same scenario. You're carrying all that extra weight and you're not used to carrying it. So, like you said, it's a double-edged sword. You're sitting at 220, 230. You got to drop 30, 40 pounds either way. That's crazy.
Or put it on.
Yeah, or put it on. And that's hard to put on 30 pounds.
I'd be willing to bet that both of these gentlemen out there are every bit of 285 pounds. As we wrap up things in period number one, your typical heavyweight match,
back and forth,
maybe some opportunities, and this is a perfect plan by Silverio.
Just defer.
You know that you're in a perfect opportunity to maintain some serious ground time and some riding time rather.
Absolutely.
And get your point and take it.
I think he's got to get a fall here just to get a little bit of pride back to West Liberty. You need to get a fall. We haven't had a fall all night.
Right.
I think it'd be a good way for West Liberty to end the match.
I have a feeling he's going to run that half. Mr. Predictor in the house. I just have a feeling he's going to run that half.
Knee in the crotch, breaking flat, shoot the half. That's what the big guys do, don't they?
Nice little trip down by Silverio there. And he's going to ride. He's going to ride and And needless to say, Coach Doyle is in the grill.
Coaching
of Corey,
to the
of
end.
Corey Siegfried, mm-hmm. And he is in the grill of him. And, he, you know, and at the same time, he's got to keep working to avoid getting called for stalling.
And you know what? Siegfried, he's working hard. You know, he's trying to get out of there. He ain't lax. He ain't resting on his laurels. He's out there trying to get out. And he's got a little hustle in his butt there, trying to get that 1 point get out away from him.
Well, you know what the good thing is the crowd is still here. You've got a pretty big margin of victory here for Willing Jesuit, and the crowd hasn't left yet. You know, they stay till the end here. They love their college wrestling here.
Man, well, I tell you what, 1 point could separate this match anyway.
Absolutely.
If Siegfried mm-hmm. can get up out of this and avoid the ride time, which is the huge key here, avoid the ride time, right. Get up and get this back to neutral.
Right.
Severio was unable to get inside on him, was unable to keep a single, was unable to do a lot of the things.
Siegfried's out. There's one. There's one. He's winning 1-0.
That could be the separating factor there.
That could be the decisive point right there.
Because you know he's going to ride him for a second. That minute's irrelevant.
You know what else I love to notice? I like to notice the little things. You know what else I love to notice? I love that Siegfried was the first one on the line.
Yes.
I love the guy. I love the guy. And, I wasn't always the guy. Maybe I had a little jab for the guy
right.
before I got back up and ran back. Maybe
right.
I had a nice little jab for
little
the jab in the summer. You know? But I was always a guy that made it a point to be the first one on
right.
that line ready to go if we're going to go back right. neutral. And I take put a lot of stock into things like that.
Sure.
And
that's pride. And
that's
even
another,
if you are tired.
That's another Sean Doyle check.
Absolutely.
Right.
Well, here's right. something to think about if you're the coach of West Liberty. You've got 1 point locked on for riding time. Do you go under and that start coming down? Or do you just go neutral and secure, you know, maybe lock it up?
Why don't you go on top and start your ride time right off top?
I'm telling Corey Siegfried, you want to be locked up with this kid as long as you possibly can. You don't want him on top of you, and you do not want to try to ride him because this Silverio, he's a brick house. He's a post. He's a sit-out turn-in away from reversing you
right.
and changing the entire aspect of this match.
Right.
So the fact that he deferred, that Silverio was able to defer in period number two, if I were Silverio, I would put exact.
I just don't know if I like this because if I'm losing one second, he loses that point.
Right.
He's a sit-out turning away from reversing him and ending it.
But if he lets him out, it's 1-1. He loses his ride time.
Now it's 1-1.
Well, the ride time's already out. He's
right.
only five. He's still a minute five away
yeah,
from it.
But
anyway.
My whole thing is, Matt, if Silverio goes on top third period and he rides him for 2 seconds, he's got that locked up until – Siegfried can get on top and ride.
Well, he had the choice, right?
Yeah.
Silverio had the choice.
And you knew he was taken down. But if it were me, I would have put him on top too.
I probably would have put him on top too.
And that's situational wrestling.
Yeah, right. I mean, at this point, he's wrestling for himself. The team's out of it, but you still have to do the best thing for you out there and give yourself the best chance to win.
You don't ever want to lose to a guy who's not ranked.
You just never want to lose. I mean, but it happens. And we have a minute and 19 seconds to go in the third period. We have a 1-1 tie between Corey Siegfried, a Willing Jesuit, and number 5 ranked Aaron Silverio out of West Liberty. We're neutral. We're going back to the center of the mat to start over again with 1 minute and 9 seconds.
I'm fine with it getting chippy, too, when we get to the bigger weights. I'm perfectly okay with the whistle blow and a little nice little chop
Absolutely.
To the chest afterwards.
That keeps everybody involved.
I don't mind it getting chippy once we get to these heavier weights and things of that nature, because it's not like you're not going to see more than in the last two matches, you're not going to see more than 3 shots taken in.
Why is that?
You want me to tell you?
Because you don't want 200 pounds, 285 pounds landing on top of you when you get under there.
We got 50 seconds remaining, third period, 1-1.
Silverio looking to take advantage here. Siegfried looking to be the spoiler.
I think Siegfried's going to work his butt off here the last 40 seconds.
He better, Scott, or else this is going to be just another W, or just another L, excuse me. Silverio looking to wrap up. They're locked up there, looking to gain wrist control. Siegfried setting himself up nicely for a nice little shrug Russian, getting that kind of top over control from the wrist to the bicep. Silverio showed very good defense, though.
Silverio looks a little bit tired.
Of course he is.
I think Siegfried, he looks a little more energetic than him. If nothing else, maybe to pull the upset here.
Now, with that double over for some reason that Silverio was going, again, he's giving he's giving Corey Siegfried anything he wants to have.
Absolutely.
He's giving him he's giving him double underhooks. He's giving him complete miscontrol and neutral. Why? I mean, I just would wish that somebody would tell this kid that he needs to pull the trigger.
We're going to go into overtime.
Overtime again.
Overtime with the heavyweights.
And Severio just got banged for a stalling warning. So
right, he hasn't done much for about a period and a half.
That's because he's taking steps back.
Mm-hmm.
So we go to overtime now, and Rick, go over the rules for overtime one more time.
Overtime, we'll go a minute. We'll go a minute. First wrestler to score wins the match. After that, if no one scores, they'll each get 30 seconds top, 30 seconds bottom. Regardless, if somebody scores in that first 30 seconds, they'll do the second.
Oh, nice shuck.
If no one scores, they'll do that again. And
see? And I didn't mean to interrupt
once
you,
he's
see?
Back right
see,
there.
See how he walked back, Rick?
Right.
This
he's
is
tired.
Corey Siegfried needs to take this match and take it now.
I'm right. Just curious, you know, if Severio doesn't get involved, will the official hit him for a stall?
He should if he doesn't get involved, Rick. That's the rules.
Yeah.
I mean, and I haven't seen him do anything for almost two periods now.
And like I said, he's been giving him everything but the kitchen sink.
Right.
Double underhooks, complete total wrist control. He's had that left knee sticking out forward, almost stepping on him like they're doing a dance out there. And Siegfried just not taking advantage. Bill DeFabio was almost a casualty there. The PA,
yes,
PA announcer
got
Bill DeFabio
put
two hands up like, oh, no.
15 seconds remaining.
Right.
Sudden death, first
who wants
sudden
it?
Death overtime. Siegfried's continuing to stalk, and Silverio just
Silverio
walking
continues
backwards.
Continues to go backwards. I don't know why. There it is.
They got
there
him
it
with
is.
The story
they got
again.
2-1. That's
what
ball game.
Unfortunately, I hate to say it because these are all student athletes and great kids out there, but that's a demoralizing way to lose.
Well, you know, it absolutely
that's
is. But you know what? You can control
the rules.
You need to not back up. You know you're stalling. You're a college wrestler. You've got to move forward. It's a 1-1 tie. Get in there and
yeah,
and
you can't move backwards on a 1-1 tie in overtime. You cannot continue to move backwards. And I'm glad he finally called. He gave him two
so
periods.
What will
something.
That make the final, 25-6?
25-6.
25-6.
That will be your
wow.
final. We have it wrapped up here from the Almond Grace
wow.
McDonough Center. Thank you to Cardinal Cast. Thank you, Rick Walker. Thank you, Scott Jackson.
Absolutely,
Matt. I'm Matt Antonucci, and this is another W for the Wheeling Jesuit Wrestling Team. Final thoughts, guys.
It was a huge win. I thought that it was going to be more competitive than that. It was a huge win. Coming out winning the first five matches before halftime was absolutely gigantic.
It set the tone for an annihilation, and you know what? I thought it was going to be a lot closer than that too, Rick. To end up 25-6, the Wheeling Jesuit University Cardinals over the West Liberty Hilltoppers.
Well, looking at some things here into the future now, we have the Midwest Classic and, of course, the Big Dog Garden Grapple in the Garden.
Jesuits got it.
Live from historic
Madison
Square Garden.
Garden.
It's going to be
New York City.
21st of December.
Sean Doyle has just got these guys.
The home that Bruno Sammartino built, if you will.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Madison Square Garden.
That's right.
Great evening tonight, guys.
What a great opportunity to get in there, just as my final thought. So many great opportunities for Coach Doyle and the Cardinals. Great opportunity here tonight to beat West Lib at home. Great opportunity at that Midwest Classic to really flex the Wheeling Jesuit
right.
muscles, and even a bigger opportunity to stick the Wheeling Jesuit Cardinal program inside of historic Madison Square Garden.
It's going to
be
amazing.
That is absolutely amazing.
Right.
So great for this program. So
absolutely.
Great for Coach Doyle and those wrestlers.
Absolutely.
All right, gentlemen, that is a wrap. Wheeling Jesuit gets the win over West Liberty 25-6. A huge win here from the McDonough Center for the Cardinal wrestling team. Congratulations to the wrestlers and Coach Doyle and his assistant coaches as well. And this is Matt Antonucci alongside my broadcast partners Rick Welker and Scott Jackson. We'll be signing off here from Cardinal Cast. Good night, everyone.
Good night.